This message, The Smyrnaean Church Age, by Brother William Marin Branham, was delivered on Monday evening, December the 6th, 1960, at the Branham Tabernacle in Jeffersonville, Indiana, USA. Hier die boodskap, die Smyrna kerktijdperk, deur broer William Marion Branham oorspronkelijk gelever in Engels op dinsdag aand, 6 December 1960, by die Branham Tabernacle in Jeffersonville, Indiana, VSA.
Most glorious Father, we are so glad tonight to know that we have in our beings immortal life, the life of our God, separated by tongues of fire and set upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and begin to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance.
Mees glorierike Vader, ons is so bly vanavond om te weet dat ons in ons wesens ons sterflike lewe het. Die lewe van onze God het verdeel in vier tonge en op elkeen van hulle gaan sit, en hulle is allemaal vervul met die Heilige Gees en het begin praat in ander tale soos die Gees hulle uiting gegee het.
O Father, how we thank Thee that Thou did divide Thyself amongst the church. No wonder our Lord said, that day you'll know that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, I in you, and you in me, how the God of heaven dwells among His people.
O Vader, hoe ons U dank, dat U U self verdeel het onder die kerk. Geen wonder onze Heere het gesê nie. Daar die dag sal julle weet, dat ek in die Vader is, en die Vader in my, en ek in julle, en julle in my. Hoe die God van die hemel onder sy mense woon.
A little while and the world won't see me no more. Yet you shall see me, for I will be with you, even in you, to the end of the world. Down through every church age, you'd be here. The same yesterday, today, and forever, and we would know you by the works that you perform. These signs shall follow them that believe.
Een klein tydjie in die wereld sien my nie meer nie, maar julle sal my sien, want ek sal met julle wees, selfs in julle tot die volleinding van die wereld. Af deur elke kerk tydperk sou u hier wees, dieselfde gister, vandag en tot in ewigheid. En ons sou u ken aan die werke wat u doen. Vir die wat geglo het, sal hierdie tekens volg.
Lord, seeing the climax.
Amen.
Of all ages, time is fixing to run out, and eternity sets in. Father God, we are so glad to know that we're living in that remnant today, watching our lives and seeing the kind of objectives we have, the motives we have, and seeing that the Holy Spirit has took over.
Here ten aanskoue van die klimaks van alle eeuwen. Tijd is bezig om uit te loop en eeuwigheid kom in. Vader God, ons is so blij om te weet ons leven in daardie oorblijfsel vandag. Deur na ons levens te kyk en die soort streves te sien wat ons het, die motive wat ons het, en te sien dat die Heilige Gees oorgeneem het.
God, may every person in divine presence tonight realize these church ages that we're living in and flee quick to the Lord Jesus. For it is so plainly written that the name of the Lord is a mighty tower. The righteous run into it and are safe.
God mag elke persoon in goddelike teenwoordigheid vanaand, hierdie kerktydperke waarin ons woon, besef, en vinnig vlug na die Here Jesus, want daar staan so duidelik geskrywe dat die naam van die Here 'n sterk toring is. Die regverdige vlug daarin en is beskut.
O God, come tonight and anoint our being, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Bring the wanderers. O Lord, it's so confused. Look at the poor sheep, Lord. They don't know what to believe. Their shepherd calls from everywhere.
O God, kom vanavond en salf ons wese, Here. Bring die swerwes, o Here, wat so verward is. Kyk na die arme skape, Here. Hulle weet nie wat om te glo nie, daar is herderkrete van oral.
We pray, Father, that they'll hear that great shepherd of the flock, the Lord Jesus, His great spirit speak tonight and say, child of mine, Come unto me and I'll give you the Sabbath, the rest that seals you to your eternal destination.
Ons bid, Vader, dat hulle daar die groot herder van die kudde, die Here Jesus, sy groot gees sal hoor, spreek vanaand. Sê, kind van my, kom na my toe, en ek sal jou Sabbat gee, die rus wat jou seel, tot jou ewige bestemming.
Not be tossed about upon the earth, as we see the time running out now. Grant it, Father, speak through the speaker, listen through the ears of those who hear, for we all are listening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You be seated.
Die om rondgegooi te word op die aarde soos ons nou die tyd sien uitloop nie. Skenk dit, Vader, praat deur die spreker, luister deur die ore van die wat hoor, want ons almal luister. In Jesus' naam bid ons. Amen. Mag maar so.
Now tonight, we are studying at the second church age. I see many have taken notes and things, and that's the reason I want to make this plain each time.
Nou vanavond bestudeer ons die tweede kerktydperk. Ek sien baie van hulle wat notas en dinge neem, en dis hoekom ek dit elke keer wil duidelik maak.
Now the second church age was called the church age of Smyrna. And it taken place, the Smyrna age was issued in at the same time the Ephesian age went out. The Ephesian age was from A.D. 55 to A.D. 170. The Smyrna age come in at 170 and goes to 312.
Nou, die tweede kerktijdperk is die kerktijdperk van Smyrna genoem. En dit het begin die Smyrna tijdperk, het dieselfde tijd ingekom dat die Ephesiese tijdperk opgehou het. Die fysische tijdperk was vanaf 55 na Christus tot 71 na Christus. Die Smyrna tijdperk het ingekom in 71 en gaan voort tot 312.
This church is the persecuted church, the one that wears the martyr's crown, is a church of tribulation. And God's promise to it, to the elected church in it, was to give it a crown of life.
Hierdie kerk is 'n vervolgde kerk, die een wat die martelaarskroon dra, is 'n kerk van verdrukking, en God se belofte daaraan, aan die uitverkore kerk daarin, was om dit 'n kroon van lewe te gee.
Each church had a star that was held in God's hand which represented the messenger to that church age. The best that I could think was a messenger at the Ephesian church age, because the Bible does not say who they are, was Paul.
Elke kerk het 'n ster gehad wat in God se hand gehou is, wat die boodskapper verteenwoordig het na daardie kerktydperk. Die beste wat ek kon dink wat die boodskapper na die Efesiese kerktydperk was, want die Bybel sê nie wie hulle was nie, was Paulus.
Because he established the Ephesian church and was the minister of that church age that brought the light to the church, which St. John taking it up from there, and then Polycarp on down.
Want hy het die Efesiese kerk gevestig en was die prediker van daardie kerk tydperk wat die lig na die kerk gebring het, wat Johannes dit opgeneem het daarna, en toe Polycarpus en verder aan, Polycarpus liewer verder aan.
Now, the Smyrna age, I believe with all the that I have been able to find, was Irenaeus. And now I want to give you the reason why that I chose Irenaeus instead of Polycarp.
Nou die Smyrna tydperk, ek glo met al die wat ek in staat was om te vind, was Irenaeus. Nou wil ek vir julle die rede gee waarom ek Irenaeus gekies het in plaas van Polycarpus.
Now, most all clergymen wants to think, and Bible teachers, that that angel was Polycarp. Polycarp was a disciple of St. John, that is true. And Polycarp sealed him, he was a martyr. They stabbed him out of the heart and killed him.
Nou, die meeste geestelikes wil dink, en Bybelleraars, dat daar die engel Polycarpus was. Polycarpus was een discipel van Johannes, dit is waar. En Polycarpus het geseel, hy was een martelaar. Hy het hom reg in die hart te steek en hom doodgemaak.
Now, but he was a great man, a notable man, a godly man, sweet. No doubt one of the greatest Christians we've ever had. And there was nothing you could say against his life.
Nou, maar hy was 'n groot man, 'n gerekende man, 'n goddelike man, minsaam. Sonder twyfel een van die grootste Christene wat ons ooit gehad het. Daar was niks wat jy teen sy lewe kon sê nie.
The reason that I chose Irenaeus because I believe that Irenaeus was more closer to the scripture than Polycarp was. Because Polycarp leaned kindly towards the Roman idea of setting up an organization. And Irenaeus was firmly against it. He absolutely denounced it.
Hoekom ek Irenaeus gekies het, omdat ek glo Irenaeus was baie nader aan die skrif as wat Polycarpus was. Want Polycarpus het soort van geleen na die Romeinse idee van 'n organisasie opstel. En Irenaeus was sterke kant daarteen. Hy het dit absoluut veroordeel.
And then, as we all know, the great issue was coming at the Nicene Council. One of the great issues was whether God was three or God was one. And Irenaeus took the side that God was God. Now, it just one.
En dan, soos ons almal weet, die groot geskil het gekom by die Niceense Raad. Een van die groot geskille was of God drie was of God een was. En Irenaeus het die kant gekies dat God God was, nou net een.
I might read from the Ananiasing Fathers, volume 1, page 412, just a little quotation, if you want to put that down. Volume 1 of the Nicene Fathers. And on page 12, and it's, if you want the volume, it's the last part of volume 3.
Ek mag lees uit die Pre-Niceense Vaders, volume 1, bladsy 412. Net 'n klein aanhaling, as jylle dit wil neerskryf, volume 1 van die Pre-Niceense Vaders. En op bladsy 12, en dis die, as jylle die volume wou hê, dis die laaste deel van volume 3.
You might read the whole thing, is several chapters of it, or several sentences. Now I'll begin to read right at the last, about the last 20-30 verses of it. I won't read it all, but just part of it.
Julle kan die hele ding lees, daar verskeie hoofstukke daarvan of verskeie sinne. Nou ek begin lees reg by die laaste 20-30 verse daarvan. Ek sal dit nie alles lees nie, maar net deel daarvan.
All the other expressions likewise being out the title of one and the same being. See, he's trying to say what they called him, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, and he said that's titles, not names, titles of the one being. That's exactly what we teach yet today.
Amen. All the other uitdrukkings wat soort gelyk is, wat die titel uitbring van een en dieselfde wese. Sien, hy probeer sê wat hulle hom genoem het. Vader, Seun, Heilige Gees, en hy het gesê, dis titels, nie name nie, titels van die een wese, dis precies wat ons nog vandag onderrig.
As for the example, and then in parentheses, in English, the Lord of power, the Lord Father of all, God Almighty, Most High, Creator, the Maker, and such like, these are not the names and titles of succession of different beings, but of one and the same. Amen.
So as byvoorbeeld, en dan in Hakies, in Engels, die magtige Here, die Here Vader van almal, God Almagtig, Allerhoogste Skepper, die Maker en Silkles. Hierdie is nie die name en titels van opvolging van verskillende wesens nie, maar van een en dieselfde. Amen.
By the name of which the one God, Father, is he who All these things grant to all of existence, the boom of all existence.
Met die naam waardeer die een God Vader is. Hy wie al hierdie dinge skenk aan al die van bestaan, die seun van alle bestaan.
Irenaeus says that all these titles are summed up into one name under one God. And there are only titles of what he was. He was the Rose of Sharon. That's what he was. That's a title. He was the Morning Star. He was Alpha. He was Omega. That's titles of what he was. He was Father. He was Son. He was Holy Ghost.
Irenaeus sê dat al hierdie titels word opgesom in een naam onder een God en hulle is net titels van wat hy was. Hy was die Roos van Sharon, dis wat hy was. Dis 'n titel. Hy was die Morgenster, hy was Alpha, hy was Omega. Die titels van wat hy was Vader, hy was Seun, hy was Heilige Gees.
But there's one God.
Amen.
One God and his name is one. And that's one reason that I thought Irenaeus was correct in his diagnosis here or interpretation of the scripture.
Maar daar's een God. Een God en sy naam is een. En dis een rede waarom ek dink Irenaeus was reg in sy diagnose hier of uitleg van die skrif.
Another thing that I'd like to read you, it's found in the book How Did It Happen? And this is by the historians. And how did it happen? By R.C. Hazleton, The History of the Early Churches. And here on page 180, The Spiritual Gifts in Irenaeus' Time, A.D. 177 to 202. Now, the reason I'm quoting this, it's going on tape, you see, and it'll be taken off on books.
Nog iets wat ik graag voor jullie wil lees, dis in die boek. Hoe het dit gebeur? En dit is deur die geskiedkundiges. En hoe het dit gebeur? Deur R.C. Hazeltine, die geskiedenis van die vroeë kerk. En hier op bladsy 180, die geestelike gawes in Irenaeus se tyd 177 tot 202 na Christus. Nou, hoekom ek hierdie aanhaal? Dit gaan op bandopname, julle sien, en dit sal afgeneem word op boeke.
It was in Irenaeus' time that the most of the apostolic church of France had all the gifts of the Holy Ghost. That was from him teaching. Irenaeus' church members at Lyons, that's Lyons, France, spoke with tongues.
Dit was in Irenaeus' tyd waar die meeste van die apostoliese kerk van Frankryk al die gawes van die Heilige Gees gehad het. Dit was van sy leersien, Irenaeus' kerklidmate by Lyon, dis Lyon, Frankryk, het in tale gepraat.
It was not uncommon to see someone dead brought back to life. Healing was an everyday occurrence in all the evangelical churches everywhere. At Irenaeus knew how to teach.
Dit was nie ongewoon om te sien dat iemand wat dood was weer lewendig gemaak is nie. Genesing was 'n alledaagse gebeurtenis in al die evangeliese kerke oral. Daardie Irenaeus het geweet hoe om te onderrig.
Miracles were frequent. In fact, those churches were never without a miraculous manifestation of God's presence, either by vision, superstition of the elements of nature, in a miracle to remind the evangelical Christians of that day, there was his beloved disciples.
Wonderwerke het dikwels gebeur, trouwens, daardie kerk was nooit sonder 'n wonderbaarlike manifestasie van God se teenwoordigheid of deur visioen onderbreking van die elemente van die natuur in 'n wonderwerk om die evangeliese Christene van daardie dag te herinner dat hulle sy geliefde disippels was.
But from the histories of the past we cannot glean a single instance of raising the dead in the first Roman church. That's people that don't not interested in either side. They're just telling the truth. It's historians.
Maar uit die geschiedenissen van die verlede kan ons nie 'n enkel geval van die opwekking van dooies in die eerste Roomse kerk vind nie. Dis mense wat nie geïnteresseerd is in enige kant nie. Hulle vertel net die waarheid. Dis geskiedkundiges.
That's why I think Irenaeus, because you see, he had the same faith that Paul and the disciples had handed down. That's why I believe that he was the angel of the church of Smyrna. Because he had the same scriptural teachings. And the same scriptural teachings upon the basis of God's word will produce the same thing every time.
Amen. Dis waarom ek dink Irenaeus, omdat jy sien, hy het dieselfde geloof gehad met Paulus en die disciples nagelaten. Dis waarom ek het glo dat hy die engel van die kerk van Smyrna was. Omdat hy was, hy het dieselfde skriftuurlike leringe gehad. En dieselfde skriftuurlike leringe op die basis van Godse woord sal elke keer dieselfde ding voortbring.
If you will just simply take God's formula and carry it out to the letter, no matter what the churches say, just follow it just the way it says, it'll produce the same thing. And that's what Irenaeus did.
As jy net eenvoudig Godse formule sal neem en dit uitvoer tot die letter, maak nie saak wat die kerke sê nie, dit het volg soos dit gesê het, sal dit dieselfde ding voortbring en dis wat Irenaeus gedoen het.
Now I think that Polycarp was a fine man, understand, but I say that he leaned too much to organize the church and like the Nicolaitans was doing.
Nou ek dink dat Polycarpus 'n goeie man was, verstaan, maar ek sê dat hy te veel geleen het na om die kerk te organiseer en soos die Nicolaïte gedoen het.
They were organizing the church and bringing a brotherhood together, which seems all right intellectually. But you see, the spirit is so far ahead of the intellectual, so that you can't even think right to the spirit.
Hulle het die kerk georganiseer en 'n broederskap by mekaar gebring, wat intellektueel reg lyk, maar jy sien die gees is so ver voor die intellektuele, totdat jy nie eers reg kan dink vir die gees nie.
My thoughts are higher than your thoughts, saith God. My ways are higher than your ways. So there's only one way to do that, just follow him by the blueprint.
Amen.
That's right.
My hoë gedagtes is hoër as julle gedagtes, sê God. My wee is hoër as julle wee, so daar is net een manier om dit te doen. Dis volg hom net volgens die bloudruk, dis reg.
Now we might think, if you was going from here, if I was going to Chicago tonight, I might get out here and get me a compass and say, now let's see, Chicago sets right this way. All right, I'll take right off. I wouldn't get out of Jeffersonville. See?
Nou, ons mag dink as jy hier vandaan gaan, as ek Chicago toe sou gaan vanaand, mag ek hier uitgaan en vir my 'n kompas kry en sê, nou laat ons sien, Chicago is net in hierdie richting. Goed, ek sal sommer gaan. Ek sou nie uit Jeffersonville uitkom nie sien.
I got to get me a road map. And it's a way lined out that I can go to Chicago in 6 or 7 hours of travel by automobile. But I can't just cut anyway.
Ek moet vir my 'n padkaart kry en daar sal 'n pad uitgelê waar volgens ek na Chicago toe kan gaan binne 6 of 7 uur se reis per automobiel. Maar ek kan nie net enige pad volg nie.
The airplane just can't cut anyway. He's got a airline or a certain height and things that he has to fly. A certain degrees that he has to stay in. There's a way made and God has a way.
Die vliegtuig kan nie net enige pad volg nie. Hy het 'n vlugplan van 'n sekere hoogte en dinge wat hy moet vlieg van sekere grade waarop hy moet bly. Daar is 'n weg voorsien en God het 'n weg.
Amen.
God has a way for his church, for his people. And he never did intend it to be controlled by popes, cardinals, archbishop or general overseers.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit is the tutor of the church of the living God. The reason.
God het die weg vir sy kerk, vir sy mense. Hy het nooit bedoel dat dit beheer word der pause, kardinale, artsbiskop of algemene opsieners nie. Die Heilige Gees is die leermeester van die kerk van die lewende God om dit op te rig.
And all the holiness don't go to a cardinal or a priest to make him a holy man in the church anything. The laity is just as right, much right to the Holy Spirit as any preacher, pastor, deacon, trustee, whatever more. Laity.
En al die heiligheid gaan nie na 'n kardinaal of 'n priester om hom 'n heilige man in die kerk enigiets te maak nie. Die leegedom het net soveel reg, net so reg tot die Heilige Gees as enige prediker, pastoor, diaken, trustee, wat ook al, leegedom.
And the reason they call it Nicolaitans, as we had last night, Nicolaitan, we broke the word down, took it from the Greek, and N-I-C-K-O meant Nicol, which means to conquer, or to overthrow.
En die rede waarom hulle dit Nicolaitite noem, soos ons gister aangehaad het, Nicolaitite, ons het die woord afgebreek en dit uit die Grieks geneem en N-I-K-O beteken Niko, wat beteken om te oorwin of om ver te werp.
What? N-I-C-K-O, Nicolaitan, laity. To conquer the laity and overthrow it by giving them an order of man, clergyman, that would teach them and would they would get their own conclusions together.
Wat N-I-K-O Nicolaitite leekedom, om die leekedom te oorwin en dit omver te werp deur hulle orde te gee van manne geestelikes wat hulle sou leer en sou hulle eie gevolgtrekkings byeenbring.
That's how the Nicene Council was held. Because many got together and fixed up an order in the Nicene Council. We ain't going to talk too much on it because that's Thursday nights. In the Nicene Council.
Dis hoe die Niceense Raad gehou is, omdat baie by mekaar gekom het en 'n orde in die Niceense Raad opgestel het. Ons gaan nie, wil nie te veel daarop praat, iemand, dis donderdag aand sin in die Niceense Raad.
But there's where the Roman Catholic Church was formed, out of a group of people that were converts of St. Paul and Irenaeus and St. Martin and on down.
Maar dit is waar die Rooms-Katolieke Kerk gevorm is uit 'n groep mense wat bekeerlinge van Paulus was en Irenaeus en St. Martin en verder aan.
They were converted Christians to the from paganism over to Christianity, but wanted to pull the church back into an Old Testament form of ministry, like having high priest and apostolic successions, like one pope to another pope, another pope.
Hulle was bekeerde Christene vir die van heidendom na Christendom, maar wou die kerk terugtrek in 'n Oud Testamentiese vorm van bediening, soos om hoë priesters te hê en apostoliese opvolging, soos een paus na ander paus, ander paus.
If we could go on down through this Bible, you'd find out that that's just exactly the truth and how God condemned the thing from the very beginning. And last night's church, they said, I hate it, and so did the church.
As ons verder kon afgaan deur hierdie Bybel, sal julle uitvind dat dit net precies die waarheid is en hoe God die ding veroordeel het, van reg van die begin af, van gister aan sy kerktydperk gesê, ek haat dit, en so het die kerk ook.
Amen.
God never intended the church to be run by man. God runs His church, and He runs it through gifts of the Spirit. The gifts of the Spirit is in the church to correct the Spirit.
God het nooit bedoel dat die kerk deur manne bestuur word nie. God bestuur sy kerk en bestuur dit deur gawes van die Gees. Die gawes van die Gees is in die kerk om die Gees te korrigeer.
He's got 5 ministerial offices in His church. First of them is apostles, or missionaries. Missionary is the highest calling there is. Apostle. The word missionary means one sent. Apostle means one sent. Why they ever chose to be called a missionary, I don't know. But they are apostles.
Hy het 5 bedieningsamte in sy kerk. Eerste van hulle is apostels of sendelinge. Sendeling is die hoogste ambt, maar daar is apostel. Die woord sendeling beteken gestuurder, apostel beteken gestuurde. Hoekom hulle ooit gekies het om 'n sendeling genoem te word, weet ek nie, maar hulle is apostels.
Are apostles, prophets, teachers, evangelists, pastors. Now that's the elected offices of God to his church.
Goed, apostels, profete, leraars, evangeliste, pastore. Nou, dis die uitverkore ambte van God aan sy kerk.
Then in each local church there's 9 spiritual gifts that come among the people. That is knowledge, wisdom, gifts of healing, working of miracles, speaking with tongues, interpretation of tongues, and all these things go in each local body.
Dan is daar in elke plaaslike gemeente 9 geestelike gawes wat onder die mense kom. Dit is kennis, wysheid, gawes van genesing, wonderwerke doen, in tale praat, uitleg van tale. En al hierdie dinge gaan in elke plaaslike liggaam in.
And every person in the church has an individual ministry. And that individual ministry goes together with the rest of the ministry to edify the body of Jesus Christ.
En elke persoon in die kerk het 'n individuele bediening, en daardie individuele bediening gaan saam met die res van die bediening ter stigting van die liggaam van Jesus Christus.
Amen. And never, now remember this, that here is, I'll draw these lines tonight. The first church, Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea.
En nooit, nou nou dit dat hier is, ek sal hierdie lyne vanaand trek. Die eerste kerk, Efese, Smyrna, Pergamus, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea.
Now, remember as this goes on, this church had the fullness of the Spirit. But at the end of the church age, we find that it was being pressed out.
Nou, onthou soos hierdie aangaan, hierdie kerk het die volheid van die Gees gehad, maar aan die einde van die kerk tydperk het ons gevind dat het besig was om uitgedruk te word.
The next church age pressed a little more. Till this one, there was just a little teeny speck. You have a few things, he said, when we get to that Thyatira church age.
Die volgende kerk tydperk het nog 'n bietjie gedruk, nog 'n bietjie, tot hierdie een. Daar net 'n baie klein stukkie was. Jy het 'n paar dinge het hy gesê, wanneer ons by daardie Thyatira kerk tydperk kom.
Now, after that come God raised up a German by the name of Martin Luther that swung the church back again. It started out a little more. He preached justification. Along come Martin Luther. Preached justification.
Nou na dit gekom het, het God 'n Duitser met die naam van Martin Luther opgerig wat weer die kerk teruggeswaai het. Dit het 'n bietjie meer begin. Hy het regverdigmaking gepreek. Martin Luther het gekom, regverdigmaking gepreek.
Along come John Wesley and preached sanctification. Then in this church age here, they come right straight back again to the baptism of the Holy Ghost again.
Amen.
With the same signs and wonders coming right down.
John Wesley het gekom en heiligmaking gepreek. Toe in hierdie kerktydperk hier, het hulle weer reguit teruggekom na die doop van die Heilige Gees met dieselfde tekens en wonders wat reguit afgekom het.
Here's where it went out through 1500 years of dark ages. And there's where the darkest and the longest church period we had in the church ages.
Hier's waar dit uitgegaan het deur 1500 jaar van donker eeue en daar's waar die donkerste of die langste kerkperiode wat ons in die kerktydperke gehad het.
Then here's where it starts coming out, justification, sanctification, baptism of the Holy Ghost, and the Bible says that in the end of this age that this little minority here will be squeezed down because the same church of Pentecost will start doing the same thing they started back here, Nicolaitans.
Dan hier's waar dit begin opkom het, regverdigmaking, heiligmaking, doop van die Heilige Gees. En die Bybel het gesê aan die einde van hierdie tydperk, dat hierdie klein minderheid hier verdruk sal word, want diezelfde kerk van Pinkster zal diezelfde ding begin doen wat hulle destijds hier begin het, Nicolaïte.
Oh God, let me keep my mouth shut till I get to that. What I can see there. See, until you can see here, and I'll show you that the messenger to this church age will hate denominations.
Amen. Amen.
The Spirit will raise up in the children. It's always been.
O God, laat ek my mond toehou totdat ek daarby kom. Sien julle wat ek daar kan sien. Sien totdat julle hier kan sien. En ek sal julle wys dat die boodskapper na hierdie kerktydperk denominasie sal haat. Die gees sal in die kinders opkom. Dit was altyd.
And now, we got it. Now, if you notice this, how it was great here, went out, finally smothered it all the way out. Then it starts back. Luther pulled it back. Justification. Sanctification, baptism of the Holy Ghost, and then right at the end time, he smothers it right down until this is almost completely gone out.
En nou het ons, nou as julle hierdie sal oplet, hoe dit groot hier was uitgegaan het en dit uiteindelik heeltemal versmoor het, dan begin dit terugkom. Luther het dit teruggetrek, rechtvaardigmaking, heiligmaking, doop van heiliges, en dan recht in die eindtijd versmoor het dit heeltemal totdat hier die omtrent heeltemal uit is.
There's just a little teeny bit there, and that's when he screams that if he don't cut the work short for the elected sake, there will be no flesh saved.
Amen.
See? There you are right at the end time. Now bear that in mind.
Daar's net 'n baie klein deeltjie hier, en dis wanneer hy uitroep dat, as hy nie die werk kort knip om die uitverkorenes se ontwil nie, daar geen vlees gered sou word nie. Sien, daar het julle dit reg in die eindtyd. Nou, hou dit in gedagte.
Now we're going to start on this Smyrna church age. First I want to break it down here on some paper that I have. Now the second church age being Smyrna. And I believe you'll all agree with me, or hope you do, or halfway anyhow, that Irenaeus was the star of that church age.
Nou kan ons begin met hierdie Smyrna kerktydperk. Eers wil ek dit afbreek hier op 'n papier wat ek het. Nou die tweede kerktydperk wat Smyrna is, en ek glo julle sal almal saamstem met my, of ek hoop julle sal, of halfpad in elk geval, dat Irenaeus die ster van daardie kerktydperk was.
He was God's messenger, because he swept the country in the French Gaul, down in there, and he established churches, and everyone of them established upon the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking in tongues, raising the dead, healing the sick, stopping the rains, and performing miracles daily. They know that the living God lived among the people.
Amen.
Amen. He was God's boodskapper when he deur die land gegaan in Frankrijk, Galilea, in daaronder, en hy het kerke gevestig, en elkeen van hulle is gevestig op die doop van heiliges, praat en taal, opwek van dooies, genesing van siekes, stop van reën en doen van daaglikse wonderwerke. Hulle het geweet dat die lewende God onder die mense woon.
That was a man of God.
Amen.
Because Jesus said, no man can do, the people said, no man can do these works except God be with him. It was Nicodemus that told Jesus that.
Dit was die man van God, maar Jesus het gesê, geen mens kan doen, of die mens het gesê, geen mens kan hierdie werke doen, as God nie met hom is nie. Dit was Nicodemus, wat dit vir Jesus gesê het.
Now, a city of commerce, a trading outlet to Lydia and to the west, the third largest city in Asia, a great harbor city, noted for wealth, temples, buildings, schools, medicine and science.
Nou, 'n stad van handel, 'n handelsafsetgebied na Lydia en na die weste. Die derde grootste stad van Asië, 'n groot hawestad, bekend vir rykdom, tempels, geboue, skole, medisyne en wetenskap.
Jews lived at Samaria, and they evangelized the Samaritan people. Polycarp was the first bishop of Samaria. Polycarp and other faithful servants established the deep faith of God in the believing Samaritans. Early church fathers give exhortation of the truth to Samaria.
Jode het gewoon by Smyrna, en hulle die mense van Smyrna geëvangeliseer. Polycarpus was die eerste biskop van Smyrna. Polycarpus en ander getroue dienaars het die diep geloof van God gevestig in die gelovige Smyrnese. Vroege kerkvaders het aansporing aan die waarheid aan Smyrna gegee.
The church age of Smyrna, the name of the church was Smyrna rather, that means bitterness. Myrrh, it's associated with dead, because they were dying.
Die kerktijdperk van Smyrna, die naam van die kerk was Smyrna. Smyrna, liever, dit betekent bitterheid, myrrh. Dit word geassocieer met die dood, want hulle was sterven.
A persecuted church, God called them persecuted. God looked upon their persecutions and gave grace to bear it. He looked upon his tribulations and gave them victory over death. Looked upon their poverty and gave them riches in him.
Een vervolgde kerk. God het hulle vervolg genoem. God het gekyk na hulle vervolging en het genade gegee om dit te verdier. Hy het gekyk na sy verdrukkings en hulle oorwinning oor die dood gegee. Gekyk na hulle armoede en hulle rykdom in hom gegee.
The church of Smyrna passed through the fiery furnace of tribulations, but was a sweet-smelling savior unto him.
Die kerk van Smyrna het deur die vuur oond van verdrukkings gegaan, maar was 'n welriekende geur vir hom.
That's that remnant now, not the whole Smyrna church, just the remnant I'm speaking of. The great 10 days of tribulation means 10 years of the bloodiest persecution.
Dis nou die oorblyfsel, nie die hele Smyrna kerk nie. Net die oorblyfsel waarvan ek praat. Die groot 10 dae van verdrukking beteken 10 jaar van bloedigste vervolging.
I don't know whether I spell his name or pronounce it or not. This was the emperor at that time, I believe, was the bloodiest one of all of them since Nero in 67. D-I-O-C-L-E-T-I-N. During the year of 303 to 312 A.D.
Ek weet nie of ek hierdie naam kan spel, of dit uitspreek of nie. Dit was die keiser in daardie tyd. Ek glo was die bloeddorstigste van hulle almal sedert Nero in 67. D-I-O-C-L-E-T-I-A-N-I-S. Gedurende jaar 303 tot 312 na Christus.
God exhorts Smyrna to be faithful unto death as he was, and I will give you a crown of life as the Father has given me. God promised the overcomer in tribulations the victory over the second death. Fear not them which can kill the body, but he that can destroy the soul, kill the soul.
God spoor Smyrna aan om getrou te wees tot die dood soos hy was. Ek sal vir jou 'n kroon van die lewe gee soos die Vader my gegee het. God het die oorwinnaar in verdrukking, die oorwinning oor die tweede dood beloof. Moenie hulle vrees wat die liggaam kan doodmaak nie, maar hy wat die siel kan vernietig of die siel kan doodmaak.
The Samaritans was to endure to the end, fear not man, and a crown of life will be given you. The persecution of Christianity in the ages are typed in the church ages of Samaria are very important. We want to get to it just in a little bit, Lord willing.
Dit, die Smyrnese moes tot die dood uithou. Moenie die mense vrees nie en 'n kroon van die lewe sal vir jou gegee word. Die vervolging van Christendom in die eeue wat tipeer word in die kerktydperke van Smyrna is baie belangrik. Ons sal daarby wil uitkom binne 'n oomblik as die Here wil.
Now, if some of you missed some of these, why, if I write them a little too fast for the rest of the class, then you can certainly get them from us anytime you want to. We'd be glad to give them to you. Excuse me.
Nou, as party van julle sommige hiervan mis terwyl, as ek hulle 'n bietjie te vinnig skryf vir die res van die klas, dan sal kan julle hulle beslis enige tyd wat julle wil by ons kry. Ons sal bly wees om hulle vir julle te gee. Verskoon my.
Now, on the second chapter and the eighth verse we begin tonight. Now what did we leave him on last night? He was certainly hated that Nicolaitan. Is that right?
Nou oor die tweede hoofstuk in die agste vers begin ons vanavond. Nou waarby het ons hom gelos gisterand? Hy was beslis daar in Nicolaït gehaat. Is dit reg?
Now what does God do? What we have found out first, the revelation of Jesus Christ. Who he is and what he is. Now the next great thing we find out, that he hates anything that will put anything to rule over his church besides himself. He is a jealous God.
Nou wat doen God? Wat moes ons eerst uitvind? Die openbaring van Jesus Christus, wie hy is en wat hy is. Nou die volgende groot ding vind ons uit dat hy enig iets haat, wat enig iets sal plaas om oor sy kerk te regeer, behalwe hy self. Hy is 'n jaloerse God.
How I like to stop, because we just got four verses here, just to quote a little something. How many can remember when the good prophet Samuel, when all of Israel wanted to act like the rest of the world? You remember that?
Hoe ek sou wil stop, want ons het net vier verse hier, net om ietsie aan te haal. Hoeveel kan onthou toe die goeie profeet Samuel, toe die hele Israel, wil maak soos die rest van die wereld? Onthou julle dit?
And the prophet told them, said, you're wrong. But they wanted to act like the Philistines and like the rest of them. Well, that's exactly what happened in this very first church age.
En die profeet het vir hulle gesê, julle is verkeerd, maar hulle wou maak soos die Filistyne en soos die rest van hulle. Wel, dis precies wat gebeur het in hierdie heel eerste kerktydperk.
It's strange that people don't want God to lead them. They want to they want some man. Israel made the greatest mistake it ever made when grace had already provided them a prophet, a leader, provided them a lamb as an atonement, and provided them food from the heavens, and all the good things that grace had provided them.
Dis vreemd dat mense nie wil hê dat God hulle moet lei nie. Hulle wil volg, hulle wil 'n man hê. Israel het die grootste fout gemaak wat het ooit gemaak het, toe genade het alreeds vir hulle profeet voorsien, een leier, vir hulle lam as een voorsiening voorsien, en vir hulle kos uit die hemel voorsien, en alle goeie dinge wat genade vir hulle voorsien het.
And still in Exodus 19 they wanted the law. They want to make doctors of divinity and have some man. They want to have something to do into it too.
En steeds in Exodus 19 wou hulle een wet hê, hulle wou dokters van Gods geleerdheid maak, en sommige manne hê, hulle wou ook iets daarmee te doen hê.
Man's always trying to outsmart the very creator that made him. And he doesn't do a thing but kill himself. As a few Sundays ago I preached on the hybrid religion. That's exactly when you hybrid anything, it's done, it's finished. It can't come back no more.
Die mens probeer altyd die eenste skepper wat hom gemaak het uitoorlê en hy doen niks behalwe om homself dood te maak. Soos ek 'n paar Sondae gelede gepreek het oor die baster godsdienst. En dis presies, wanneer hy enigiets verbaster, kan dit nooit dis gedaan, dis klaar praat. Dit kan nie meer terugkom nie.
A mule can never breed back and have another mule. Because he's a mule. He's a hybrid. Fine corn. You can't raise fine corn off of fine hybrid corn. It won't even, it might come up, or it's no good at all. You can't do it. Anything that's hybrid's no good.
A muil kan nooit terugteel en nog een muil hê nie, want hy's a muil, hy's a baster. Goeie koring, jy kan nie goeie koring kweek van goeie baster koring nie. Dit sal nie eers, dit mag opkom, maar dis niks werd nie. Jy kan dit nie doen, enig iets wat verbaster is niks werd.
And a hybrid religion is no good.
Amen.
As long as you're trying to add something to what God said, or do something that God don't want you to do, it's a hybrid religion.
En 'n baster godsdienst is niks werd, solank as wat jy iets probeer bijvoeg by wat God gesê het, of iets doen wat God nie wil hê jy moet doen nie, is dit 'n baster godsdienst.
It might look pretty. Old hybrid corn will outshine the natural corn. An old mule outwork two horses. That's, it ain't working, brother. It's grace that we're thinking about. Not by works are we saved, but by grace.
Dit mag mooi lyk, o baster koring sal mooi lyk as die natuurlijke koring. Een ou muil sal harder werk as twee perde. Wel dis nie werk nie, broer, dis genade waardeur ons gered word. Nie deur werke word ons gered nie, maar deur genade.
So, that might, I hope you don't think these remarks, you're sitting under strain, and I feel it up here, see? Because there's Presbyterian, Methodists, and all kinds in here, we know that. And I feel it, you have to relax yourself a little once in a while. Get that shake off like.
So dit mag, ek hoop nie hierdie opmerkings, jylle sit onder een spanning, en ek voel dit hierboe, jylle sien, want daar is Presbyterian, Methodists, en allerhande soorte hier binnen. Ons weet dit, en so ek voel dit, en jy moet jouself een bykie ontspan nou en dan, daar die afskut soort van.
Now, listen, anything's hybrid is no good, you've got to take the original way God made it, then you've got something that's real.
Amen. Nou luister, enig iets verbaster is niks werd, jy moet die oorspronkelike neem, soos God het gemaakt het, dan het jy iets wat ek is.
Now, we find out then, that this Church of Israel, as they passed on, God had fed them and taken care of them and done everything for them. And finally they looked over to the Philistines and the Amorites and different ones and said, we want a king. They got something we ain't got.
Nou, ons vind dan uit dat hierdie kerk van Israel, soos hulle aangegaan het, God hulle gevoed het en vir hulle gesorg het en alles vir hulle gedoen het. En uiteindelik het hulle oorkant na die Filistyne gekyk en die Amorite en die en verskillendes en gesê, ons wil een koning hê, hulle het iets wat ons nie het nie.
That's the same thing the people does today. One of these, our sisters, will look over at the television and see Glory Swanson or whoever, some of them women with a certain kind of a dress on and they just can't stand it till they get one. See?
Dit is dieselfde ding wat die mense vandag doen. Een van hierdie ons sisters sal oorkant naar die televisie kyk en Gloria Swanson sien of wie hulle ook al partij van haar die vrouwe met een sekere soort rok aan en hulle kan dit net nie uithou tot hulle een kry nie. Sien?
You see some woman downtown, oh isn't that darling? What do you care what you wear? People, it's just that way. I said it's a day of impersonation. Somebody wants to impersonate the other.
Julle sien 'n vrou in die dorp. Hoe is dit nie fraai nie? Wat gee jy om wat sy geëet het en kon aantrek? Mense, hulle is net so. Ek het gesê, dis die dag van nabootsing. Een wil die ander naboots.
You take the... There's so many Elvis Presleys now, I tell you, you couldn't sack them up in boxcars. Because he become popular. Carnal comp... impersonations. We have the same thing in religion.
Jy neem die daar soveel Elvis Presleys nou, ek sê jou, jy kon hulle nie opstapel in treinwaans nie, omdat hy gewild geword het in vleeslike nabootsings. Ons het dieselfde ding in godsdienst.
I was reading the history of Martin Luther, and any of you historians know, they said it wasn't a mysterious thing that Luther could protest the Catholic Church and get by with it, but the greatest mystery is he could hold his head above all the fanaticism that followed his revival. Amen. Still stay with the word. That's the miracle, how God kept him clear and straight.
Ek het die geschiedenis van Martin Luther gelees. En enige van julle geschiedkundiges weet. Hulle sê dit was nie raaiselachtig dat Luther teen die katholieke kerk kon protesteer en daarmee kon wegkom nie. Maar die grootste raaisel was dat hy sy kop bo al die fanatisme kon hou wat op sy herleving gevolg het en steeds by die woord geblei het. Dis die wonderwerk, hoe God hom suiwer en opreg gehou het.
Now, so they come to this Samuel, they said, make us a king. And the Lord told him, he rejected that idea, just exactly what he rejected here with organization.
Nou, so het hulle na hierdie Samuel toegekom. Hulle het gesê, maak vir ons een koning. En die Heer het vir hom gesê dat hy die idee verwerp het, net precies wat hy hier met organisatie verwerp het.
Just like he rejected that. He rejects organizations. He don't reject organism, but organization. Organism, we have to have that, but organization we don't have to have, because it draws lines.
En soos hy daar die verwerp het, verwerp hy organisaties. Hy verwerp nie organisme nie, maar organisatie. Organisme, ons moet dit het. Maar organisatie hoef ons nie te hee nie, want dit trek lyne.
We are so and so. Are you a Christian? I'm Methodist. Are you a Christian? I'm Baptist. That don't mean no more than a pig in a pen. It has nothing to do with it. Not at all. A Christian.
Ons is so en so. Is jy Christen ex Methodist? Is jy Christen ex Baptist? Dit beteken niks meer as 'n vark in 'n hok nie. Dit het niks daarmee te doen nie, glad nie, 'n Christen.
Asked a girl one night on the platform, are you a Christian? She said, well, I give you to understand I burn a candle every night. Like that had anything to do with Christianity.
Ek het 'n meisie een aangevra op die platform, is jy 'n Christen? Sy het gesê, wel, ek sal jou sê dat jy weet, ek brand 'n kers elke aand. Asof dit enigiets te doen het met Christendom.
Another man said, well, I'm an American, sure. Well, that's got nothing to do with it.
Amen.
Not a thing. You're a Christian because you belong to another kingdom.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
And you're in another kingdom above.
De ander man het gesê, wel, ex-Amerikaner, sekerlik. Wel, dit het niks daarmee te doen, hoe gaan hom niks? Jy is 'n Christen omdat jy aan 'n ander koninkryk behoort, is reg. Jy is in 'n ander koninkryk van bo.
Now, what did Samuel do? Just the same thing that God did here. Samuel called Israel together. He said, now listen to me, I want to ask you something. Has there ever been one time that I ever told you anything that wasn't true?
Nou wat het Samuel gedoen? Net dieselfde ding wat God hier gedoen het. Samuel het Israel by een groep, hy het gesê, luister na my, ek wil vir julle iets vra. Was daar ooit een keer wat ek vir julle iets vertel het wat nie waar was nie?
So now I'm God's prophet among you. Tell me one time I ever told you anything in the name of the Lord that didn't come to pass.
Amen.
That's what Samuel said to him.
Amen.
Gesê ek is God se profeet onder julle. Sê vir my een keer waar ek julle ooit enig iets vertel het in die naam van die Here wat nie gebeur het nie. Dis wat Samuel vir hulle gesê het.
He said, and hasn't God fed you and taken care of you and done all these things? Said you're doing sin by trying to act like the other nations.
Hy het gesê, en het God julle nie gevoed en vir julle gesorg en al hierdie dinge gedoen nie? Gesê, julle doen sonde om te probeer maak soos die ander volke.
Oh, they said, he said, I want to ask you something else. Have I ever took any money away from you? Have I ever begged you for an offering? Or have I ever told you anything in the name of the Lord that didn't come to pass? They said, no, you never took our money, that's true. And you've never told us anything in the name of the Lord that didn't come to pass.
Hoe het hulle gesê? Hy het gesê, ek wil vir julle iets anders vra. Het ek al ooit enige geld van julle weggevat? Het ek julle al ooit gesmeek vir offerande? Of het ek julle al ooit enig iets vertel in die naam van die Here wat nie gebeur het nie? Hulle het gesê, nee, jy het nooit ons geld gevat nie, dis waar. En jy het ons nooit enige iets vertel in die naam van die Here wat nie gebeur het nie.
He said, then hear me. You're sinning by trying to act like the rest of them. But they want a king anyhow. Regardless what's right or wrong, they want to carry out their idea.
Hy het gesê, luister dan na my. Julle sondig om te probeer maak soos die res van hulle. Maar hulle wou in elk geval 'n koning hê, ongeag of dit reg of verkeerd was, hulle wou hulle idee uitvoer.
That's the same thing the church did right here at Ephesus.
Amen.
They've taken the Nicolaitan doctrine, and when they did it, pushed them right into convert paganism and Christianity together and caused a 1500 years of dark ages.
Amen.
And when Luther pulled them out, if the second round the Lutherans didn't do the same thing they did back in Ephesus.
Amen.
Exactly.
Dis dieselfde ding wat die kerk gedoen het net hier by Efese. Hulle het die Nicolaïtiese doktrine aanvaar en toe hulle het hulle hulle rig inforceer om heidendom en Christendom te laat saamkom en 'n 1500 jaar van donker eeue veroorsaak. En toe Luther uitgetrek het as die tweede ronde, die Lutherane nie dieselfde ding gedoen het wat hulle destyds in Efese gedoen het nie. Precies.
Now if you'll notice, the candlesticks,
didn't sit quite like that. They started down in this way and come up. Well, the highest one away from where he was standing was this one up here.
Nou as jylle sal oplet, die kandelaars het nie precies soos daarin gestaan nie. Hulle het begin afloop op hierdie manier en opgekom. Wel die hoogste een weg van waar hy gestaan het, was die een hierbo.
And Christianity gradually smothered out as it went from where he was standing in the shape of the cross, which we'd seen in the fourth chapter, and the shape of the cross like this, and this was his right hand, that was his left hand.
En Christendom het geleidelik uitgedoof soos dit uitgegaan het van waar hy gestaan het in die vorm van die kruis, soos ons hom in die vierde hoofstuk gesien het, in die vorm van die kruis soos hierdie. En hierdie is sy rechterhand, daardie was sy linkerhand.
Now, right here, he had his hand on this church and on that church. He was both Alpha and Omega, and of course all was in between the two, all the other letters, but he specifically said Alpha and Omega. He had a rainbow over his head, which was his covenant.
Nou net hier het hy sy hand op hierdie kerk gehad en op daardie kerk. Dit was beide Alpha en Omega. En natuurlijk, alles was tussen die twee, al die ander letters. Maar hy het specifiek gesê Alpha en Omega. Hy het 'n reënboog oor sy hoof gehad, wat sy verbond was.
Now, if you notice, the light of Pentecost, where it started, gradually smothered out. These men, Irenaeus, Polycarp, all the rest of them, sealed their testimony with their blood. Until it finally squeezed Christianity into the dark as the day.
Nou, as jylle oplet, die licht van Pinkster waar dit begin het, het geleidelik uitgedoof. Hierdie manne Irenaeus, Polycarpus en al die rest van hulle, het hulle getuienis verseël met hulle bloed, totdat dit uiteindelik Christendom inforceer het in die donkerste dae.
Now look, the first age, the other side of that great hump coming over, was a little bit of light, and more light. See how it begins to shine again coming onto that day. And now at the end of this age, it's predicted here that it come to a Laodicea lukewarm.
Nou kyk, die eerste tydperk aan die ander kant van daardie heuwel, wat oorgekom het met 'n bietjie lig, meer lig toe, meer lig. Sien hoe dit weer begin skyn soos daardie dag nader kom, nou aan die einde van hierdie tydperk word dit hier voorspel dat dit sou kom by 'n Laodiceese, a lukewarm.
Now, here it is. Why, if this thing here brought them to this, why would we want that down here in Pentecost?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yes.
And you know the Bible said there'd be a beast, and we know that's a Roman papacy.
Amen.
That's exactly right.
Nou, hier is dit. Wel, as hier die ding hier, hulle hier laat beland het, waarom sou ons dit hieronder in Pinkster wil hê? En julle weet die Bybel het gesê daar sou 'n dier wees, en ons weet dis die Romeinse pausdom. Dis presies reg.
And then they would form an image to that beast. What is an image? Something made like it.
Amen.
And that's a confederation of churches.
Amen.
And Pentecost is in it.
Amen.
It'll come a time where you'll either belong to an organization or you can't keep your door open.
Right.
Now you see if that isn't true.
En dan sou hulle 'n beeld vir daardie dier vorm. Wat is 'n beeld? Iets wat soos dit gemaak is. En dis die raad van kerke. En Pinkster is daarin. Daar sal 'n tyd aanbreek waar jy of sal behoort aan 'n organisasie, of jy kan nie jou deur oophou nie. Nou kyk julle of dit nie waar is nie.
It's the reason we pound it to death. Yes, sir. You and even lower than that, they'll try to seek you so bad they'll try to won't let you buy or sell as you've got that organization mark on you. It brings it right in.
Dis hoekom ons dit doodslaan. Ja, meneer, jy is nie in staat. Laar as dit, hulle sal jou so probeer bykom, totdat hulle sal probeer om jou nie sal laat koop of verkoop, as jy nie daardie organisasie merk op jou het nie. Dit bring dit reguit in.
Just exactly like that day. They burn them. I stood there in that arena, wept like a baby, when I look up there where the gladiators would sit, and that old arena there, and
net precies daardie dag, let hulle verbrand, hulle, ek het daar gestaan in daardie arena, gehuil soos 'n baba, toe ek daar opgekyk het waar die swaardvegters so sit, in daardie ou arena daar en.
And see them things and know that many of my Christian brethren was eaten by lions and tore to pieces on the ground there, and women and little children and things.
En daar die ding gesien en weet dat baie van my Christen broers geëet is dier leeuws en verskeer op die grond daar en vrouwe en klein kinderkies en dinge.
Now think if they all went down in faith, would I let them down now? No, sir, brother.
Hallelujah.
God let me stand for the faith that was once delivered to the
Amen.
Saints.
Amen.
That same thing, no matter how unpopular.
En ek dink, as hulle allemaal gesnevel het in geloof, sal ek hulle nou in die steek laat? Nee, meneer broer, God laat my staan vir die geloof wat eenmaal aan die heiliges oorgelever is. Daar die selde ding, maak nie saak hoe ongewild.
Somebody's always won't say, well, someone said not long ago, oh, how many great ministers on the field has called me and said, Brother Branham, if you don't stop that, every organization will be against you. Well, I said, there's one it won't be, that's the one that's in heaven. That's the one I'm looking for.
Iemand wil altijd sê, wel, iemand het lang geleden gesê, o, hoeveel groot predikers oor die veld mee gebel en gesê, Brother Branham, as jy nie gaan ophou daarmee nie, sal elke organisatie teen jou wees. Wel het ek gesê, daar is een wat nie sal wees nie, dis die een wat in die hemel is, dis die een waarna ek soek.
See, now I love people in every organization, sure. But have I ever told you anything that the Lord, in the name of the Lord didn't come to pass? Has everything been said and been done right?
Sien, nou ek is lief vir mense in die elke organisatie, sekerlik. Maar het ek julle ooit enig iets vertel by die Here in die naam van die Here wat nie gebeur het nie? Sien, is alles gesê en reg gedoen.
Have I ever begged you for money? Then stay out of the organizations. You stay free in Christ. Let the Holy Spirit always move in and out the church.
Het ek julle ooit gesmeek vir geld? Bly dan uit die organisaties. Bly julle vry in Christus. Laat die Heilige Gees altyd in en uit die kerk beweeg.
The only thing that matter, get all these little differences away from you, little isms and little funny feelings around you for brethren and things like that. Shake it away. Don't let no root of bitterness ever get into your soul. If you do, it'll canker you. Right.
Die enigste ding wat verkeerd is, kry al hierdie klein verskilletjies tussen julle uit. Klein ismes en snaakse klein gevoelentjies in oor julle broers en sulke dinge skud dit af. Laat geen wortel van bitterheid ooit in jou siel inkom nie. As dit sal dit jou verkanker, reg.
Keep love. I don't care how much people hate you, you love them anyhow. If you can't do that, you ain't sealed, you got a loose place yet. So come on back and get that sealed up right good with the blood of Christ. It'll cleanse you from all roots of bitterness. Yes.
Behou liefde, ek gee nie om hoeveel mense jou haat nie, het jy hulle in elk geval lief. As jy dit nie kan doen nie, het jy nodig die, jy die nie, is jy nie verseel nie, jy het nog een losplek, so kom aan terug en kry dit goed verseel met die bloed van Christus, dit sal reinig van alle wortels van bitterheid, ja.
Now, see what we're trying again, the Pentecostal blessing fell about 1906 somewhere in there, there's a minister sitting with us tonight, a missionary from Tibet, I don't say it because it's his presence, I hope he didn't go home, I think he's still here. You go to speak for us a little before I come down?
Nou sien, maar ons probeer weer. Die Pinkstersering het rondom 1906 geval, daar iewers. Daar is een prediker wat onder ons sit vanavond, een sendeling van Tibet, een van diewe. Ek sê dit nie omdat hy teenwoordig is nie. Ek hoop nie hy is huis toe nie. Ek dink hy steeds hier, so vir ons bietjie preek voor ek afkom.
And that man remembers the first of Pentecost. There wasn't any organization. Everybody had things in common. Oh, how easy it is to take the wrong step right there. And how good it looks to the intellectual.
En daar die man onhou die eerste van Pinkster. Daar was nie enige organisatie nie, allemaal het dinge in gemeen gehad. O, hoe makkelijk is dit om die verkeerde stap te neem net daar. En hoe goed lyk dit vir die intellectuele.
Look. Little did Israel know when they stand out there on the bank, shouting. Now you say this kind of religion is something new. Well, it's the oldest there is.
Amen.
Sure. Even before the world was ever made, they were shouting and praising God.
Kijk, min het Israel geweet, toe hulle daar buiten op die oever gestaan het geskreet. Nou julle sê, hierdie soort godsdienst is iets niets. Wel, dis die oudste wat daar is sekerlik. Selfs voor die wereld ooit gemaakt is, het hulle geskree en God geprys.
God said so, ask Job, where was he when the morning stars sang together and the sons of God shouted for joy? That's before the world's ever created.
God het so gesê vir Job gevra, waar was hy toe die toe die morgensterre saamgesing het die seuns van God uitgeroep het van vreugde. Dis voor die wereld ooit geskaap is.
But now look at Israel. Had seen miracles. That's the early Pentecost, Israel. The Pentecost of that day. Now they've been brought up out of Egypt. God had blessed them. Give them all kinds of great signs and wonders. And deliver them.
Maar kyk nou na Israel. Het wonderwerke gesien. Dis die vroeë Pinkster. Israel, die Pinkster van haar dag. Nou hulle is uitgebring uit Egypte. God het hulle geseën en hulle arre en ander groot tekens en wonders gegee en hulle verlos.
And when they stood up on that bank and had a Pentecostal meeting, they did. Amen. Now listen, Moses sang in the spirit.
Amen.
And Miriam took a tambourine and run down the bank, beat this tambourine, dancing in the spirit. Amen. And the daughters of Israel followed her, dancing in the spirit. Amen. If that ain't a Pentecostal meeting, I never seen one.
En toe hulle op daardie oewer gestaan het en 'n Pinksterdiens gehou het, hulle het, luister nou, Moses het in die gees gesing, Miriam het 'n tamboerijn gevat en afgehardloop langs die oewer, hierdie tamboerijn geslaan, gedans in die gees, die dogters van Israel het haar gevolg, gedans in die gees, as dit nie 'n Pinksterdiens is nie, het ek nog nooit een gesien nie.
Little did they believe that the promised land was 40 years ahead of them, is only about 40 miles. But it take them 40 years to get 40 miles. It's because they chose the wrong thing.
Hulle het glad nie geglo dat die beloofde land 40 jaar voor hulle was nie. Dit was omtrent 40 myl. Maar dit sou hulle 40 jaar neem om 40 myl te vorder, omdat hulle die verkeerde ding gekies het.
They chose to have a law instead of letting the Holy Spirit lead them. The pillar of fire. Take them on through and lead them. They wanted to have something to do themselves.
Hulle het gekies om 'n wet te hê in plaas van om die Heilige Gees hulle te laat lei. Die vier kolom hulle te laat deurneem en hulle te lei. Hulle wou iets hê om self te doen.
They wanted to have certain priests and certain dignitaries and a little theology they could fuss about instead of just going on and letting the Holy Ghost lead them. They were in the Spirit. God had provided everything. But they had to have something to do into it.
Hulle was sekere priesters en sekere hooggeplaastes en 'n bietjie teologie waaroor hulle kon stry in plaas van net aan te gaan en die Heilige Gees hulle te laat lei. Hulle was in die Gees, God het alles voorsien, maar hulle moes iets daarmee te doen hê.
Just like high breeding again. Let the cow alone. Let the horse alone. Let the food alone. The Science Claimed in Reader's Digest, the article of it. If they keep on high breeding food and people eat it like chickens, they got that poor chicken till they ain't got no wings or legs.
Net weer soos verbastering. Los die koe uit, los die perd uit, los die kos uit. Hulle, die wetenskap het aanspraak gemaak in Reader's Digest die artikel daarvan. As hulle aanhou kos verbaster en mense eet dit soos hoenders, hulle die arme hoenders so dat het geen vark of bene meer het nie.
And if it lays itself dead, it can only live a year. In the tissue so soft you can't hardly eat it, and people eating it is perverting people. That's right.
En as dit lê dit itself dood, hulle kan net 'n paar jaar lewe en die weefsel is so sag. Jy kan dit skaars eet en mense wat dit eet, dit verdraai mense, dis reg.
You know, homosexual is on the increase about 40% in the United States over the year ago. And did you know that science claims that women are getting wider in the shoulders and narrow in the hips, and men are getting narrow in the shoulders and wider in the hips?
Julle weet, homoseksualiteit is aan die toeneem omtrent 40% in die Verenigde State teenoor 'n jaar gelede. En weet julle, die wetenskap maak aanspraak dat vroue wyer raak in hulle skouers en nouer in hulle heupe, en mans raak nouer in hulle skouers en wyer in hulle heupe.
You're eating a perverted seed. You're eating perverted stuff. Your body was made to thrive on the natural thing.
Jy eet 'n verdraaide saad, jy eet verdraaide goed. Jou liggaam is gemaak om te floreer op die natuurlike ding.
And what's it doing is changing even the natural course of men and women. To Hollywood, even our government and everything is full of perverts. What's it doing? They're bringing it on themselves by their own tree of knowledge.
Amen.
Killing themselves.
En wat doen dit? Dit verander selfs die natuurlike ontwikkeling van mans en vroue totdat Hollywood selfs ons regering en alles vol verdraaides is. Wat doen hy? Hulle bring dit oor hulle self deur hulle eie boom van kennis wat hulle self doodmaak.
Go back to the beginning.
Amen.
Let nature alone. Let God alone. Keep the church and the Holy Ghost and get away from all these bishops and popes and all kinds of doctrines. Go back to where we started at. Go back.
Gaan terug naar die begin, los die natuur uit, los God uit, hou die kerk in die Heilige Gees en kom weg van al hierdie biskop en pause met allerhande doctrine. Gaan terug naar waar ons begin het, gaan terug.
Jesus would come tonight and say, I'm a Methodist, he'd say it wasn't so from the beginning. I'm Presbyterian, it wasn't so from the beginning. What was that beginning? A Pentecostal experience of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. That's where it began.
Jesus vanavond zou kom. So jy sê, ek's a Methodist. Hy sou sê, dit was nie so van die begin af nie. Ek's Presbyteriaans. Dit was nie so van die begin af nie. Wat was aan die begin? 'N Pinkster ondervinding van die doop van die Heilige Gees. Dis hoe dit begin het.
But see, we had to pervert it.
Yeah,
oh, it makes prettier, sure. That little church standing out there dancing and shouting down on the street and people throwing rocks at him, making fun out of him and everything like that. That ain't very pretty.
Maar sien, ons moes dit verdraai. O, dit maak dit mooier. Sekerlik, daardie klein kerkie wat daar rond gestaan en dans en geskree het en onder in die straat en mense wat klip in hulle gegooi het en hulle bespot het en alles soos daardie. Dit is nie baie mooi nie.
Now we got the great doxology and the Apostles' Creed and old Dr. PhD, LLD, so and so for our pastor. He can come out and say, oh man, like a calf of the cramps and like that, all those kind of things.
Maar nou het ons die groot doxology en die apostoliese geloofsbelijdenis en oor Dr. PhD, LLD en so vir ons pastoor. En kom het en sê, amen, soos een kalf met krampe en gaan aan soos daardie, al daardie soort goed.
Excuse me, I didn't mean to say that. Forgive me, I didn't mean to say that like that, see. I didn't mean that. That ain't becoming to a servant of God.
Verskoon my, ek het nie bedoel om dit te sê nie. Vergewe my, ek het nie bedoel om dit so te sê nie. Sien, ek het dit nie bedoel nie. Dit is nie gepas vir 'n dienaar van God nie.
But look, all them, I just come up on my mind, see. But Stan say all them different things like that. Practice before the, you know, say not. No, you don't say that right. Amen.
Maar kyk, allemaal van hulle, ek, dit het net in my kop opgekom sien. Maar staan het en sê al daardie verskillende dinge soos daardie oefen voor julle weet, sê, nou nee, jy sê dit nie reg nie. Amen.
I like a good old Pentecostal meeting where the power of God's body is screaming, shouting, praising God, having a great time. That's where the Spirit's got to hold the people.
Ek hou van 'n goeie ou Pinksterdiens waar die krag van God val en jy net gil en skree en God prys in 'n wonderlike tyd het. Die manier die Gees het die mense beet.
But we, you can't hear an amen hardly anymore to amen. However, that's where we get, you see, these organizations stiff, right?
Maar ons, jy kan skaars nog 'n amen hoor, dis 'n amen. Dis echter waar ons beland, julle sien hierdie stywe organisaties trots.
Now did was there prophecy concerning that? You remember Paul's prophecy last night? I know that after my departure, grievous wolves will enter in among you. And men of your own class, you're right in the own church, them Roman Catholic church coming up, will raise up among you and pull away disciples after them. And Paul's wolves, we find out, become Nicolaitans.
Nou die appel, was daar 'n profesie daaroor? Onhou julle Paulus' profesie gisteraand? Ek weet dat na my vertrek sal wrede wolwe onder julle inkom en manne van julle eie klas. Julle reg in die eie kerk, daar die Rooms-Katolieke kerk wat opkom, sal opstaan onder julle en disippels wegtrek agter hulle aan. En Paulus' wolwe vind ons uit, het Nicolaïte geword.
Listen to the Spirit speak through the prophet again. In the last days, perilous times shall come. For a man shall be lovers of their own self. Yeah. I'm Dr. So-and-so, don't you tell me what about it now.
Amen.
I'll give you to understand I'm a Presbyterian, hallelujah.
Luister na die gees wat weer deur die profeet spreek. In die laaste dae sal swaarte kom, want die mense sal liefhebbers van hulle self wees. Ek's Dr. So-and-so. Moet jy my nou nie wat daarvan vertel nie. Ek sal jou te kenne gee. Ek's 'n Presbyteriaan. Halleluja.
I'm a Pentecostal. What difference does that make if you're Pentecostal by nature, the experience of it? See? Yes, sir. I belong to the assemblies. I belong to the church of God. What difference does that make to God?
You ought to belong to the kingdom up there.
Yes. Amen.
That's right.
O, ek Pinkster, wat 'n verskil maak dit as jy nie Pinkster van nature is nie. Die ondervinding daarvan sien, ja meneer, ek behoort aan die gemeentes, ek behoort aan die kerk van God. Wel daarin, wat 'n verskil maak dit vir God? Moet aan die koninkryk daarbo behoort sien, dis reg.
Now, if you see the all these things, just a conglomeration of gaiety. Now, it said they'd be heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God.
Have your way, Jesus.
Oh, they can't go to church on Sunday night as long as there's some good television program on. Oh, my.
Nou, as jy sien die, al hierdie goed net op een hooping van jou leid. Nou, dit het gesê, hulle sou roekloos verwaand wees met liefhebbers van genot as liefhebbers van God. Hoe hulle kan die kerk toe gaan op Sondag aan, solang daar 'n goeie televisieprogram aan is nie. O, goeiste.
Always, even the churches has got ball teams and soup suppers and cricket parties and lovers of pleasure, more than lovers of God, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, and despisers of those that are.
Hulle altyd self die kerke het balspan en sop aan etes en kriketpartytjies en meer liefhebbers van genot as liefhebbers van God. Onpersoonlik kwaadsprekers, bandeloos, wat die goeie verag.
These despise those. These despise those, choke them out. Despisers are those that are good.
Amen.
Oh, you say they're communists, brother. Oh, no. No, no.
Hierdie wat daar die verag sien, hierdie wat daar die verag verdring hulle. Wat die wat goed is verag. O, jy sê hulle is communiste, broer. O, nee, nee, nee.
Heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, despised with those that are good, having a form,
amen,
denominational experience, see, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof,
roekeloos verwaand, meer liefhebbers van genot as liefhebbers van God, onversoeling, kwaadsprekers, bandeloos sonder liefde vir die goeie wat 'n gedaante het, die denominationele ondervinding sien wat 'n gedaante van Godsaligheid het, maar die krag daarvan verloon het.
What would it be in this day? See? Having a form of godliness. Go to church just as pious you can be on Sunday and put on the shorts on Sunday afternoon and mow the yard and have the Urdles 92 out and the pastor get outside, smoke a cigarette and come back in.
Amen.
Having a form of godliness.
Wat sou jy wees in hierdie dag sien wat 'n gedaante van godsaligheid het, gaan kerk toe net so vroom as wat jy kan wees op Sondag en trek Sondagmiddag die kortbroek aan, sny die agterplaas en haal die oortels 92 uit en die pastoor gaan uit en rook 'n sigaret en kom terug, jy weet wat 'n vorm van godsaligheid het.
Well pastor, they got a church up there, they tell me the lady got healed the other day from a camp. Nonsense. Days of miracles is past.
Ja, pastoor, hulle het 'n kerk daarbo, hulle het vir my gesê, dame is genees nou die dag van het, onsin, daal van die wonderwerk is verby.
Well, you know what? I was up to a little church the other night, that little mission down on the corner, and there was somebody getting up there, speaking something, oh, honey, don't you ever hang around such like that. That's mad dogs. Don't you fool around that. That's holy rollers. Don't you ever...
Wel weet julle wat, ek was by 'n kerkie nou die aand, in daardie klein sendingstasie onder op die hoek, en daar het iemand daar opgestaan wat iets gepraat het, o skat, moet jy nooit rondhang by sulke goed soos daar nie, dis malhonde goeiste, moet jy nie daarmee speel nie, dis holy rollers, moet jy nooit.
Having a form of godliness and denying the power thereof, from such turn away. For this is a sort that goes from house to house and leads silly women led away with divers lusts, never able to learn or ever come to the knowledge of the truth.
Amen.
That's exactly right.
Wat 'n vorm van godsaligheid het en die krag daarvan verloon het, keer jou af van hierdie mense, want uit hulle is die wat in die huise insluip en arme vroue gevange neem wat met sondes belaai is, wat nooit kan leer of ooit tot die kennis van die waarheid kan komen. Dus precies recht.
There you are. Ladies Aid Society, this society, that the poor church has got so many societies that it can't even preach the gospel no more. Amen. Pastor can't have but 20 minutes and he has to talk about something else then. See? But don't, the deacon board will meet him. Yes, sir.
Daar het julle de Dames Hoop Vereniging, hierdie vereniging, daar die arme kerk het zoveel verenigings, dat het nie eers meer die evangelie kan preek, die pastoor kan nie langer as 20 minute kry nie, en dan moet hy oor iets anders praat sien. As hulle nie sal die diakenraad om ontmoet, ja meneer.
Oh brother, what does a good pastor have to do today? Just do the best he can, stand out and cut the limbs where they want to, and let the chips fall in where they want to, and sling it out there, that's all.
Amen.
Yes sir, that's right.
O broer, wat moet een goeie pastoor vandaag doen? Net die beste doen wat hij kan om te staan en die takken af te kap waar hulle wil en die spanders te laat waai waar hulle wil en dit daar uit te slinger. Dis al, ja meneer, dis recht.
Don't spare nobody. Just preach the word and stay right with it. Just hammer out on away. If they throw you in jail, preach it in jail. If they put anywhere else, preach it where you go. Just keep on going, preaching. That's right. Now, that's what's happened. See, they're smothering it out.
Moenie enig iemand spaar nie, preek net die woord en bly recht daarby, hou net recht aan met kap, as hulle jou in die tronk gooi, preek dit in die tronk, as jy elders geplaas word, preek oral waar jy gaan, hou net aan met preek, dis recht, nou dis wat gebeur het, sien, hulle doof dit uit.
Now, we're coming to the Smyrna age, the 8th verse, unto the angel of the church of Smyrna. Write these things, saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive.
Nou kom ons by die Smyrna tydperk, die 8ste vers. Skryf aan die engel van die gemeente in Smyrna. Dit sê die eerste en laaste wat dood was en lewend geword het.
I want you to notice, every time that he introduces himself to a church age, he puts forth something of his deity.
Amen.
That's the first thing he tries to make known to the church, that that's his deity. He's God.
Amen.
Ek wil hê julle moet oplet dat elke keer wat hy homself voorstel aan 'n kerktydperk, hy iets uitbring van sy godheid. Dis die eerste ding wat hy wil bekend maak aan die kerk. Dis sy godheid. Hy's God.
You see the great issue back here that Arrhenius and them was fussing about? They try to say that the God in three cosmics and God in three persons and God in this. He said there's no such a thing. It's titles of one being and that is the Almighty God.
Amen.
That's right.
Sien julle die groot geskilpunt destijds daar waaroor Arrhenius en hulle gestry het? Hulle probeer sê dat die God in drie kosmosse en dis 'n God in drie persone en God in hierdie. Hy het gesê daar's glad nie so iets nie. Dis titels van een wese en dit is die almagtige God is reg.
So you don't, they've always said it, and God here in the beginning is introducing himself of one of his deities. You see, he's introducing himself first over here. I am he which was, which is, and shall come, and I am the Almighty.
So jy nie, hulle het dit altijd gehad, en God hier in die begin stel hem self bekend as een van sy godhede. Julle sien, hy stel homself bekend eers hier oorkant. Ek was hy wat was, wat is en sal kom, en ek is die Almachtige.
Here he starts right over with the Smyrna age now. Now listen to him. I, unto the angel of the church of Smyrna, we believe that the Arrhenius, write these things, saith the first and the last.
Hier begin hy nou dadelijk met die Smyrna kerktijdperk nou. Nou luister nou om, ek, aan die engel van die gemeente in Smyrna, en ons glo dat dit Arrhenius was, skryf, dit sê die eerste en die laaste.
See, introduce himself, I'm God now in this church age. I don't want no four or five different gods around here, I'm God, see, that's it. Which was dead and is alive, amen. Now that's the introduction.
Sien, homself bekendgestel, ek schot nou van hierdie kerktijdperk. Ek wil nie vier of vijf gode hier rond heen nie. Ek schot. Sien, dis dit, wat dood was en levend geword het. Amen. Nou, dis die inleiding.
Now, Smyrna means bitterness. And comes from the word of Myra. And the first church and had lost their first love, the Ephesian church.
Nou Smyrna betekent bitterheid. En dit kom vanaf die woord myrre. En die eerste kerk en het hulle eerste liefde verloor, die Efesiese kerk.
And this church had begun to have a root of bitterness coming up in them because that this church, the main church, the big part, a majority of them always, was hammering against the Holy Ghost ruling in the church and they wanted to rule themselves.
En hierdie kerk het begin om 'n wortel van bitterheid te kry wat opgekom het in hulle, omdat hierdie kerk, die hoofkerk, die groot deel, die meerderheid van hulle altyd gehammer het teen die Heilige Gees wat die kerk regeer en hulle wou self regeer.
They wanted to set up a priesthood. They wanted to act like the Old Testament people did. They wanted priests. If the pagan gods back there where they was converted, they had priests and so forth of Jupiter and priests of Venus and so forth. They wanted to bring them the same thing and make these men.
Hulle wou 'n priesterdom opstel, hulle wou optree soos die Ou Testamentiese mense het. Hulle wou priesters hê en hulle as die heidense gode destes daar waar hulle bekeer is, hulle het priesters gehad en so voort van Jupiter en priesters van Venus en so voort. Hulle wou dieselfde ding inbring om hierdie manne te maak.
See, the whole thing is pagan to begin with.
Amen.
All pagans has those priests and things like that, but the church of the living God is foreign to them. Christ is our priest, our high priest. We have a high priest, a table also that we eat at.
Sien, die hele ding is heidens om mee te begin. Alle heidene het daar die priesters en dinge soos daar, maar die kerk van die lewende God is vreemd vir hulle. Christus is ons priester, ons hoë priester, ons het 'n hoë priester, 'n tafel ook waar ons eet.
Now, this church had begun to spring up a root of bitterness. Why? It was bitter against those who wanted to continue on with the Holy Ghost. The love had faded away and they were trying to swap it to creeds and denominations, getting away from the Holy Ghost leadership. Think of that. That's why the bitterness was in them.
Nou hierdie kerk het 'n wortel van bitterheid dat opkom. Hoekom? Dit was bitter teenoor hulle wat wou voortgaan met die Heilige Gees. Die liefde het weggesterf en hulle wou dit verruil vir geloofsbelijdenis en denominasies, wegbeweeg van die Heilige Gees leierskap. Dink daaraan. Dis hoekom die bitterheid in hulle was.
All right. Now, the first church, the bitterness started creeping in. The second church a little more. And finally, it creeped right in because they were making a better church. They thought they were.
Goed. Nou die eerste kerk, hierdie, die bitterheid het begin insluip. Die tweede kerk 'n bietjie meer en uiteindelik het dit reguit ingesluip omdat hulle 'n beter kerk gemaak het, het hulle gedink hulle het.
Right there they had something dignified. The great Roman people could come in. Wow, they had a pope. They had great men, cardinals and so forth. They dressed fine. They got away from all the noise and everything they had. Very quiet, so they were dying. They were dying.
Net hier het hulle iets deftigs gehad en die groot Romeinse mense kon inkom. Waarom? Hulle het 'n paus gehad, hulle het groot manne gehad, kardinale en sopers, hulle het goed aangetrek. Hulle het weggekom van al die geraas en alles wat hulle gehad het, baie stil. Gewys, hulle was sterwend. Hulle was sterwend.
And so, they got a dignified, and they made a better body. The first thing up here, they had the whole thing in a big ecclesiastical denomination. A Roman universal church, a Roman Catholic church, in the dark age.
En so het hulle deftig geword en hulle het 'n beter liggaam gemaak. Die eerste ding hierbo het hulle die hele ding in 'n groot geestelike denominasie gehad, die Romeinse universele kerk, die Rooms-Katolieke kerk in die donker eeu.
Well, then they had dignitaries, they had class. Oh, it was much prettier than when they used to stand out on the street and had to walk in sheepskin and goat skins and destitute and sawed asunder and laughed at and made fun of. And as Paul said in Hebrews 11 chapter.
Ja, toe het hulle hooggeplaaste gehad en hulle het klas gehad. O, dit was baie mooier as wat hulle altyd buite in die straat gestaan het, en skaapsvel en bokvel misloop en gebrek lê en stukke gesaag en voor gelag en bespot, en soos Paulus gesê het in Hebreërs die 11de hoofstuk.
Well, this great big fine robed church with underskirts on and all this other stuff that they wear like that, sure it looked dignified. Father, Reverend Doctor, Father so-and-so, oh my, they could put on some real dog there.
Wel, hier die eislike groot, welbeklede kerk met die onderrokke aan en al hier die ander goed wat hulle soos daarie dra. Sekerlik, dit het deftig gelyk, Vader, eerwaarde, dokter, Vader, so en so, o, goeiste, hulle kon regtig 'n bietjie grand wees daar.
But you see, it was a hybrid thing, hybrid.
Amen.
See, it didn't have any life in it. And it cannot go back no more, that's the reason they never rise.
Maar jylle sien, dit was a buster, sien, dit het geen lewe daarin gehad, en jylle kan nie meer terugkom nie, dis hoekom jylle nooit opgekom het nie.
The Lutheran revival never did rise up again. The Wesley revival never did rise up again. The Nazarene revival did not rise up again. Neither will the Pentecostal revival rise up again.
Die Lutherse herlewing het nooit weer opgekom nie, die Wesleyanse herlewing het nooit weer opgekom nie, die Nazareense herlewing het nooit weer opgekom, die Pinkster herlewing sal ook nie weer opkom nie.
Why? Because you killed it. You hybrid it with the world, with the Nicolaitan idea. Not let the Holy Ghost have its way. Right? You hybrid the church, it can't breed itself back again.
Hoekom? Omdat jylle dit doodgemaak het, jylle dit verbaster met die wereld, met die Nicolaitiese idee, nie die Heilige Gees laat maak soos hy wou nie, dis reg, jylle die kerk verbaster, en dit kan nie weer dit self terugdeel nie.
When you breed back, you get more Methodist. Baptist breed back, get more Baptist.
Amen.
Catholic breed back, gets more Catholic. Get the same thing you're shelling off the ear.
Wanneer hy terugdeel, kry jy nog Methodiste. Baptiste teel terug, kry meer Baptiste. Katholiek teel terug, kry nog katholieke. Kry dieselfde ding wat jy van die kop afdop.
But let me tell you something, when the Holy Ghost comes back, it brings new birth and new life, conversion. Baptism of the Spirit brings the church back to itself again, puts life back in it.
Maar laat ek vir julle iets sê, wanneer die Heilige Gees terugkom, bring dit nuwe geboorte en nuwe lewe, bekering, doop van die Gees. Bring weer die kerk terug na homself, sit weer, lewe daarin.
Hybrid corn don't have life in it. What life it is just about sapped out. Now we get that in the dark age there. What little you have, hold on to it. It's that you all squeezed it out. Now, but it won't reproduce itself again.
Buster koring het nie lewe daarin nie. Wat lewe dit is omtrent heeltemal uitgeseig. Nou ons kry dit in die donker eeuw daar. Die bietjie wat jy het, hou vast daarin, het hy gesê. Hulle het dit alles uitgedruk gehad. Nou, maar dit sal nie homself weer kan voortbring nie.
Now, but the body of Jesus Christ is not an organization.
Amen. Amen.
The body of Jesus Christ is a mythical body.
Amen.
It is a body of in a kingdom that's a spiritual kingdom that's set up on the earth by Jesus Christ being the king of this kingdom. The high priest to offer sacrifices for the wayfaring in this kingdom.
No die, maar die liggaam van Jesus Christus is nie 'n organisasie nie. Die liggaam van Jesus Christus is 'n mystieke liggaam. Dit is 'n liggaam van in 'n koninkryk wat 'n geestelike koninkryk is, wat op die aarde geplaas is deur Jesus Christus as die koning van hierdie koninkryk, die hoë priester om offerandes te offer vir die reisiger in hierdie koninkryk.
He's a prophet, the word that preaches the truth and brings the light of God in this kingdom. And he is both prophet, priest and king in this kingdom.
Hy is 'n profeet, die woord wat die waarheid preek en die lig van God bring in hierdie koninkryk. En hy is beide profeet, priester, koning in hierdie koninkryk.
And how do we get this kingdom? By the denomination? By letter? By handshaking? But by one spirit. We are all baptized into one body, which is the mystical body of Jesus Christ, and we're baptized in there, not by water, not by sprinkling, not by pouring, not by any kind of water baptism, but by one Spirit, Holy Spirit. We are all baptized into one body. 1 Corinthians 12.
En hoe kom ons in hierdie koninkryk in? door die nominatie, door een brief, door een handdruk, maar door één geest wordt ons allemaal gedoop in één lichaam, wat die mystieke lichaam van Jesus Christus is. En ons wordt daarin gedoop, niet door water nie, nie door sprinkel nie, nie door uitgiet nie, nie door enige soort water doop nie, maar door één geest, Heilige Geest, wordt ons allemaal gedoop in één lichaam, 1 Korintiërs 12.
Yes, we are baptized into this body by one Spirit, Holy Spirit. Then we don't belong to anything but Christ.
Amen.
You are Christ. It's a mythical kingdom of God that's set up that we come into it by Holy Spirit baptism. I love that.
Ja, ons wordt gedoop in hierdie lichaam deur een geest, Heilige Geest, dan behoort ons nie aan enige iets behalwe Christus nie. Julle is Christus en dis een mystieke koninkryk van God wat opgerig is, wat ons daarin kom deur Heilige Geest doop. Ek is lief daarvoor.
There is mense almost everywhere
met
whose hearts are all on flame,
met die vuur wat vulle Pinkster,
wat ons skoon
en
rein,
word is
brandend nou hier in my heart, o Heere, sê sy naam.
Ek so blij dat ek kan sê,
I'm one of them.
Ek so blij dat ek kan sê,
I'm one of them. Hallelujah. One of them. I'm one of them. Now I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Though these people may not learn to be, or boast of worldly fame, they have all received their Pentecost baptized in Jesus' name, and they're telling now that far and wide His power is yet the same. I'm so glad that I can say I'm one of them. Aren't you glad? Just one of them, that's all.
Is julle nie bly nie? Ja, meneer, net een van hulle, dis al.
I remember walking down to Memphis. That little colored lady with her head leaned over there, she said, good morning, parson.
Ek kon hoor om deur Memphis te stap, daar die ou klein gekleerde dame met haar kop geleen daar oorkant. Sy het gesê, goeiemôre, prediker.
As I knew I was a parson. She said, the Lord told me his parson has come down the street and he's wearing a tan hat packing a suitcase. Said, I know you was him when I seen you coming. Oh, she was one of them. That's right. Oh, how God is good.
Ek het gesê, hoe het jy geweet, ek is 'n prediker. Sy het gesê, die Heer het vir my gesê. Sy prediker kom in die straat af, sal 'n breinhoed op, het tas dra gesê, ek het geweet, jy was hy toe ek jou sien kom het, sien. O, sy was een van hulle, dis reg. O, hoe goed God is.
Now I believe something. The little girl you prayed for Sunday night from Bedford is supposed to have just died. This cannot. Please have prayer. A little girl that they prayed you for here Sunday night from Bedford has just died. They said, let's have prayer.
Nou, ek glo iets, die meisiekie vir wie jy gebid het sondag aand van Bedford, het blijkbaar nou net gesterf. Dit kan nie. Bid asseblief. Meisie wat ons, hulle het hier vir haar gebid sondag aand van Bedford, het pas gesterf, het hulle gesê, laat ons bid.
Lord Jesus, I pray that somehow, some way, Lord, let our prayers go through for that child. We commit the little thing to you, our Father God. And we think of those people that were here and praying and asking prayer for that little girl.
Here Jesus, ek bid dat op 'n manier, Here, laat ons gebed deurgaan vir daardie kind. Ons vertrou die kleintjie aan U toe, ons Vader God. En ons dink aan daardie mense wat hier was en gebid het en gebed gevra het vir daardie meisietjie.
Father God, I ask that this report may not be so, Father, we don't know. But I pray that you'll have mercy and give strength and let the little thing be raised up and live for the glory of God. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask this. Amen.
Amen.
May the Lord Jesus add His blessings.
Well, Father God, ek vra dat hierdie verslag nie so sal wees nie, Vader. Ons weet nie, maar ek bid dat u genade sal wees en krag sal gee. Laat die kleintjie opgerig word en lewe tot die eer van God. In die naam van Jesus Christus vra ons dit, amen. Mag die Heere Jesus sy seëninge byvoeg.
Now, a church. Now, the church name is associated with the nature of its character. Did you notice the Smyrna meaning bitter? And you notice each one of the church now, it's the church name has something to do with the character of the church. I could say something here, but I better not. Because you'd get me wrong, see?
Nou, a kerk. Nou, die kerk se naam is verbind met sy natuur van sy karakter. Het jy opgelet die Smyrna wat bitter beteken? En jylle let op elkeen van die kerk nou, dis die kerknaam wat iets te doen het met die karakter van die kerk. Ek kon iets hier sê, maar ek beter nie, want jylle sal my verkeerd verstaan sien.
Your name does too.
Amen.
You might not know it, but it does. Oh, yes. You say, now it's numerology. No, it's not. When Jacob was born, they called him Jacob, which was supplanter. But when he wrestled with the angel, God changed his name. The Israel, a prince.
Amen.
Is that right?
Jou naam het ook. Jy mag dit nie weet nie, maar dit het, o ja, jy sê nou dis getalle leer. Nee, dis nie. Toe Jacob gebore is, het hulle hom Jacob genoem wat 'n onderkreper was. Maar toe hy geworstel het met die engel, het God sy naam verander na Israel, 'n prins. Is dit reg?
Saul was Saul of Tarsus, a mean fellow. But when he come to Jesus, he's called Paul.
Amen.
Simon's name was Simon. When he come to Jesus, he's called Peter.
Amen.
A little stone. Oh, yes, sir. That your name associates what your, it has an impression upon your character.
Saul was Saul van Tarsus, a gemene kerel. Maar toe hy na Jesus gekom het, is hy Paulus genoemd. Simon se naam was Simon, maar toe hy na Jesus gekom het, is hy Petrus genoem. 'N klippie, ja meneer, die jou naam assosieer wat jy, dis 'n indruk op jou karakter.
And this church was called a Smyrna because it was dying. Smyrna means bitterness. In other words, a root of bitterness is coming up and was choking it out. It was on its throat out. To marrow, that's what they anoint bodies with, marrow. See?
In hierdie kerk is Smyrna genoem omdat dit stervend was. Smyrna beteken bitterheid. Met ander woorde, 'n wortel van bitterheid het opgegaan en was besig om dit te persmoor. Dit was op sy pad uit na mirre. Dis waarmee hulle liggame salf, mirre, sien?
Was myrrh frankincense, as anointment, myrrh is used to anoint dead bodies after they embalmed them and so forth, associated with death, and the church was dying.
Dit was myrrh, wierook as 'n salf. Myrrh word gebruik om dooie liggame mee te salf nadat hulle gebalsem het en so voort, geassosieer met die dood, en die kerk was stervend.
No, can't you see today, friends? The great Pentecostal move that did have life a few years ago. Can't you see it's been anointed now with myrrh?
Hoe kan julle nie sien nie vandag, vriende, die groot Pinksterbeweging wat lewe gehad het 'n paar jaar gelede, kan julle nie sien dit word nou gesalf met myrrh nie?
See, the same ointment was in this church here has come plumb down and anointing this one down here, dying out because they're going back to ecclesiastical rags and taking off their white-robed saints.
Sien, dieselfde salf wat in hierdie kerk hier was, het reguit afgekom en hierdie een hier onder gesalf sterf uit omdat hulle teruggegaan het na kerkflenters en hulle wit kleed uittrek. Heiliges.
Amen.
The little people who stood out there in the genuine Holy Spirit spoke with tongues and manifested God and brother, there was an honest and all wool in a yard wide.
Die min mense wat daar buite gestaan het en 'n echte Heilige Gees gepraat het in tale en God gemanifesteer het en broer, hulle was so eerlik en suiwer wol in 'n yard breed.
They absolutely were genuine. You could trust them anywhere. Now you don't know what to trust and who to trust. See? Something's happened. Something's happened. Why? They're being anointed with bitterness. Raising up.
Hulle was absoluut echt. Jy kon hulle ooral vertrouw. Nou weet nie wat om te vertrouwen en wie om te vertrouwen nie sien. Daar is iets wat gebeur en iets het gebeur. Wat is? Hulle word gesalf met myrre van bitterheid. Staan op.
One, what calls it? One come in. There was a church called, the first was a general council. Then they called it the assemblies of God. Out of the assemblies of God come the church of God.
Wat het dit veroorzaak? Een het ingekom, daar was een kerk genoemd, die eerste was een algemene raad. Toe het hulle dit die gemeentes van God genoemd. En die gemeentes van God en die kerk van God gekom.
From the church of God, then they begin to look across and say, your assemblies. And they say, your church of God. Then out of that come the United Pentecostal Church of God on an issue.
En die kerk van God, toe het hulle begin oorkant toe kyk, sê hulle, julle is gemeentes, die ander sê, julle is kerk van God. Toe het die Verenigde Pinksterkerk van God daar het gekom oor geskil.
And then the first thing you know, instead of accepting light and walking in it, well, they've done organize themselves till they couldn't accept light.
En toe die eerste waarvan jy weet, in plaas van om licht te aanvaar en daarin te wandel wel, het hulle self klaar georganiseer, totdat hulle nie licht kon aanvaar nie.
Now, when the baptism in the name of Jesus Christ was brought forth instead of Father, Son, Holy Ghost to the assemblies of God, they had already anchored themselves so they couldn't change it.
Nou toe die doop van die naam van Jesus Christus ingebring is na die gemeentes van God, in plaas van Vader, Seun en Heilige Gees, het hulle al reeds hulle self geanker dat hulle dit nie kon verander nie.
And they know it's the truth. I challenge any of them to show that it's not right for the Bible. It's absolutely the truth. But what can they do? They can't do it. See, they break up their creed. They can't.
En hulle weet, dis die waarheid. Ek daag enige van hulle uit om te wees. Dis nie recht volgens die Bybel nie. Dis absoluut die waarheid. Maar wat kan hulle maak? Hulle kan dit nie doen nie. Sien, hulle sal hulle geloofsbelijdenis verbreek. Hulle kan nie.
Then what did the oneness do? Instead of accepting it and going yet, they got starchy. Bless God forever. We got the light and you haven't. What they do? They organized it. You can't organize God.
Amen.
God's even without form, the Bible says. Nothing formal about God.
Toe werden die eenheid toegedoen in plaas daarvan om dit te aanvaar en voort te gaan, het hulle stijf geword. Prijs die Heere voor eeuwig, ons het die licht en julle het nie, ons is die. Wat het hulle gedoen? Hulle het dit georganiseer, jy kan nie vir God organiseer nie. God is self sonder vorm, het die Bybel gesê, nie niks formeels omtrent God nie.
Now, and the assemblies try to organize him and make them, there's the real church. And then the one that's come along try to organize theirs and they had more light.
En toe het die gemeentes om probeer organiseer en hulle maak, hulle sin die ware kerk. En toe het die eenheid gekom, hulle sin probeer organiseer en hulle het meer lichaam.
So what they do, they blow it out. By their own selfish, bitter way, they went about it. Instead of giving it out with salt and sweetness, they tried to disfellowship the other and have nothing to do with him. And that's what done it. It was swept on then.
So wat hulle gedoen? Hulle het dit uitgeblaas met hulle selfsugtige, bitter manier waarop hulle te werk gegaan het. In plaas van om dit uit te gee met sout en soetheid, het hulle die ander een uit die gemeenskap probeer skop, niks met om te doen hee nie. En dis wat dit gedoen het, toe het dit verder gegaan.
The first thing you know, up come another one, they got this and now they broke up one, said, he's coming on a white horse. There's this, coming on a white cloud. Bless God, I'll start me an organization over here. See what it would do? It spread myrrh. What did it do? It shut off brotherhood.
Die eerste waarvan jy geweet het, het nog een opgestaan en het hierdie gekry en nou het hulle opgebreek. Een het gesê, hy kom op een witperk. Die ander sê, hy kom op een witbolk. Prijs God, ek sal vir my organisatie hier oor kan begin. Sien hoe hulle maak, dat het mirre versprei. Wat het dit gedoen? Dat het broederskap verhoed.
A many woman, man tonight in the assemblies of God would like to come and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Knowing it's a God's truth.
Amen.
They'd be excommunicated if they did it.
Amen.
En baie vroue mans vanavond in die gemeentes van God sal graag bekom en gedoop word in die naam van Jesus Christus in die wete dat dit Godse waarheid is. Hulle sal geëxcommuniseer word as hulle dit doen.
And of many oneness are there. Now I'm not oneness, I don't believe in the oneness the way they do. I don't believe in Jesus like they say Jesus is not a Jesus, it's the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That's right.
En baie eenheid van die nou, ek's nie eenheid nie, ek glo nie in die eenheid soos hulle glo nie, ek glo nie in Jesus soos hulle sê, Jesus nie. Daar is baie Jesusse, dis die Here Jesus Christus, dis reg.
Now, I believe that different from what they do, they baptize in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus for regeneration. That being baptized, regeneration brings in Christ to you for your water baptism.
Nou, en ek nie, ek glo dit anders as wat hulle glo. Hulle doop in die naam van Jesus, in die naam van Jesus vir wedergeboorte, dat om gedoop wedergebore te word, Christus inbring na jou vir jou waterdoop.
I don't believe that. I believe regeneration comes by the blood of Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit. That's right. Baptism is only an outward act of the inward work of generations that have been done. See? So I don't agree with that. That's all right. But they're all my brethren.
Ek glo dit nie. Ek glo wedergeboorte kom deur die bloed van Jesus Christus, deur die Heilige Gees. Dit is reg. Doop is net 'n uiterlike daad van die innerlike werk van geboorte wat klaar gedoen is. Sien? So ek stem nie daarmee saam nie. Dis in die haak, maar hulle is almal my broers.
When I first started out as a Baptist preacher, they'd come around and say, Brother Branham, you come over here. We got it. We come over here. I said, neither one of you. I'll stand right between the two groups and say, we are brothers.
Amen.
Don't care what. I don't care if a man disagrees. That don't make one speck of difference to me. He's still my brother.
Toe ek eers begin het as 'n Baptiste predikus, hulle gekom gesê, Brother Branham, kom hier na toe. Ons het dit en ons het dit hier na toe gedra. Ek gesê, nie een van julle nie. Ek sal reg tussen die twee groepe staan en sê ons is broers. Geen nie om wat nie, ek gee nie om of 'n man verskil nie. Dit maak nie 'n greintjie verskil vir my nie. Hy is steeds my broer.
I got a brother that likes apple pie. I like cherry the best, but I ain't going to disfellowship him. He can eat his apple pie and I eat my cherry pie. And I put calf slobbers on top of mine. If he don't want it, well, you can have it.
Ek het 'n broer wat hou van appeltert. Ek hou die meeste van kersie, maar ek gaan hom nie uit die gemeenskap verwyder nie. Hy kan sy appeltert eet en ek eet my kersietert. Ek sit kalfpuil op myne en as hy dit nie wil hê nie, wel, kan dit kry.
You know that what is whip stuff they put on it, you know, whipped cream? I like it. Getting too old now to eat it, but it's that's what I, if he don't like it, he don't have to eat it. That's all right. I eat mine. But he's still my brother.
Amen.
That's right.
Julle weet daar, wat is dit geklitste goed wat hulle daarop sit? Julle weet geklitste room, ek hou daarvan. Raak nou te oud om dit te eet, maar dis dis waarvan ek hou. As hy nie daarvan hou nie, hoef hy dit nie te eet nie, dis in die haak. Ek sal myne eet, maar hy steeds my broer. Dis reg.
And so I like that. I like a fellowship. But when we draw lines like this and say, no, this is our denomination, and won't reach over and shake hands with the next man and say, bless God, brother, my, that's when you call fellowship.
So, ek hou daarvan, ek hou van die gemeenskap. Maar wanneer ons lyne trek soos hierdie en sê, nee, die hierdie is ons denominatie, en wil nie oorreik en handskud met die volgende man en sê, prys God, broer nie. Goeiste, dis wanneer jy gemeenskap noem.
If you don't, you get that root of bitterness just like the Samaritans got back there. And you cause the same thing. All right, so their name was bitter.
As jy nie kry die wortel van bitterheid net soos die Smirnese destyds daar gekry het, en jy veroorsaak dieselfde ding goed, so hulle naam was bitter.
The Nicolaitans kept smothering them out until the Dark Ages. Luther's age brought out the first step of grace. A little light began to shine, then come forth. After that, come John Wesley with sanctification. Grow a little brighter.
Die Nicolaïte het hulle bly uitdoof tot die donker eeuwe. Luther se tydperk het die eerste stap van genade uitgebring. 'N Klein liggie het begin skyn. Toe het daarna uitgekom het John Wesley gekom met heiligmaking. 'N Bietjie helderder geword.
And then come the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the Pentecostals bringing back again the faith of the fathers. But they could not keep it that way. Thus they had to organize it, and then they started right back into Nicolaitan again. Just exactly what the Bible said they would do.
En toe het die doop van die Heilige Gees gekom met die Pinksters wat weer die geloof van die vaders teruggebring het, maar hulle kon dit nie so hou nie, so hulle moes dit organiseer, en toe het hulle weer reguit terug in Nicolaïte ingegaan, net precies wat die Bijbel gesê het hulle sou doen.
Now, I have to watch here, or I'll get too much time tuck up. Let's get to the second verse, or that'd be the 8th, 9th verse. All right, now the persecution. The 9th verse.
Nou, ek moet doppel hier, ek sal dit kry te veel tyd in beslag neem. Laat ons by die 2de vers kom, of die, dit sal die 8, 9de vers wees. Goed, nou die vervolging, die 9de vers.
I know thy works, thy tribulations, poverty, but thou art rich. Oh my. Now he's talking to the church now, the real church, not the others. They hated the deeds of Nicolaitans. I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but they are the synagogue of Satan.
Ek ken jou werke, jou verdrukkings, armoede, maar jy is ryk, o goeiste ek. Nou praat jy met die kerk nou, die ware kerk, nie die ander nie. Hulle het daar die werke van die Nicolaïte gehaat, die lastering van die wat sê dat hulle Jode is en dit is nie, maar een synagoge van Satan.
Now, they were complaining. They were poverty stricken. They had taken all they had. They'd built up their little church like this, and if they were such a little bitty group, they'd pushed them out. The big church had. They smothered them out.
Nou, hulle het gekla. Hulle was armlastig. Hulle het alles gevat wat hulle gehad het. Hulle het hulle klein kerkie opgebouw tot hierdie, en omdat hulle so een baie klein groepie was, het hulle uitgestoot, die grootkerk het hulle net uitgedoof.
And said, I know, you have to meet down on the corner, you meet in the alley or anywhere else that you can, and I've been in the catacombs where they have to meet, go down under the ground and meet, and things like, I know your tribulations, and I know your troubles, and so forth like that, but you're made rich through those tribulations.
En dit het gesê, ek weet, jylle moet op die hoek vergader, jylle moet ontmoet in die steegie of elders waar jylle kan. Ek was in die katakombes waar hulle moes vergader, ondergronds gaan en vergader en dinge. Ek ken jou verdrukkings en ek ken jou probleme en soop as wat daardie, maar jy word ryk gemaakt dier daardie verdrukkings.
Oh my, tell me anytime a persecution comes up on the church, it strengthens it. Always it strengthens the church in tribulations. I know your tribulations, but you're rich. Why? You've held on to me. You're rich. But your tribulations ain't hurting you.
O goeiste, sê my van enige tyd wat die vervolging van die kerk kom, dit versterk dit. Dit versterk altyd die kerk in verdrukkings. Ek ken jou verdrukkings, maar jy is ryk. Hoekom? Jy het aan my vasgehou, jy is ryk. Maar jou verdrukkings maak jou nie seer nie.
Now, did you notice? The Nicolaitans had got themselves a synagogue now. The Bible said so here. Did you notice it here in the 9th verse? Which are not, but are the synagogue of Satan.
Nou die, het jy opgelet, die Nicolaïte het nou vir hulle self een synagoge gekry. Die Bijbel het so gesê hier. Het dit hier in die 9de vers opgelet, waar dit nie is nie, maar een synagoge van die Satan.
The true church had been pushed out. The Nicolaitans had taken over. And they pushed out the people that had the Holy Ghost, so therefore they didn't have no use for them.
Die ware kerk is uitgedrukt, die Nicolaïte het oorgeneem, en hulle het die mense wat die Heilige Gees gehad het uitgedrukt, so daarom het hulle geen nut vir hulle gehad.
If Smyrna in Asia had only knew that the things that martyrs' crowns would await them, they would have shook. See?
As Smyrna in Asia net geweet het dat die dinge, daar die martelaars krone wat vir hulle gewag het, sou hulle gebewe het sien.
Now, in other words, when this prophecy was written and was set down and the church got a hold of it and they seen they was the ones go to wear the martyrs' crown, well, they'd scare them to death. They just look at any time for it. It didn't come in their age.
Nou met andere woorden, wat toe hierdie profesie uitgeskryf is en so toe gestuur is, en die kerk dit beet gekry het, en hulle gesien het, hulle was diegene wat die martelaars kroon so dra, wel dit sou hulle doodsvrees gegee het. Hulle het dit enige tyd verwag, het nie in hulle eeuw gekom nie.
Then maybe some of them said, well, you know, I tell you, that prophet was wrong. John was wrong. He because it didn't happen to us here in Smyrna. Well, it was to be hundreds of years later. See, but when God speaks anything, it has to come to pass.
Toe het sommige van hulle miskien gesê, wel, jy weet, ek sê jou, daardie profeet was verkeerd, Johannes was verkeerd, hy, omdat dit nie hier met ons in Smyrna gebeur het nie. Wel, dit sou honderde jare later gebeur sien, maar wanneer God enig iets spreek, moet dit gebeur.
Man. That's where we sink our faith, right there, on God's word. God keeps every promise.
Amen.
No matter, you might think it has to happen right here, but maybe that's not God's time for it to happen.
Amen. Dis waar ons geloof insink, net daar op Godse woord. God hou elke belofte, maak nie saak. Julle mag dink, dit moet net hier gebeur, maar miskien is dit nie Godse tyd daarvoor om te gebeur nie.
But my word will not return to me void. But it will accomplish that which it was purposed for. God will always honor his word and in his own good time it'll reap.
Maar my woord sal nie leeg na my terugkeer nie, maar dit sal bereik waarvoor dit bestem was. God sal altyd sy woord eer en in sy eie goeie tyd sal dit maai.
So these people was the one, the first church, but in that church was the characteristic that would come out in the Smyrna church later on. Now, then they were to wear a martyr's crown. Many of them was to be killed.
So hierdie mense was die een, die eerste kerk, maar in daardie kerk was die karaktereienskap wat so uitkom in die Smyrna kerk later aan. Nou, dan moes hulle die martelaars kroon dra. Baie van hulle sou doodgemaak word.
Now, let's take the 10th verse as we read this. Fear none of these things, the synagogue of Satan, which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast you into prison, that ye may be tried, and it you shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life.
Nou kom ons vat die 10de vers soos ons hierdie lees. Vrees vir niks, die sinagoge van Satan, wat jy sal lei nie. Kyk, die duivel gaan van julle in die gevangenis werf, sodat julle op die proef gestel kan word. En julle sal 10 dae lang verdrukking hê, maar wees getrou tot die dood toe, en ek sal jou die kroon van die lewe gee.
Oh my. They were told not to fear when they were called on to die for their religion. Now, Sister Woods, wherever you are, I hope this helps you. Sister Woods was telling me the other day she couldn't hardly understand why some could be delivered and others not.
Hoogweeste, hulle word gesê dat hulle nie moet vrees wanneer hulle geroep word om te sterf vir hulle godsdienst nie. Nou, Sister Wood, waar jy ook al is, ek hoop, Here help jou. Sister Wood het my nou die dag gesê hoe dat sy nie kon verstaan hoe sommige verlos kon word en ander nie.
Sometimes you have to know. God told these people, now don't you fear about it. Because Satan's going to cast you in there because of this Nicolaitan outfit that's coming pushing you in, because I'm going to let you die for my cause, but I'll give you a crown of life at that day.
Partykeer moet jy weet, God het vir hierdie mense gesê, nou moet julle nie hier oor vrees nie, want Satan gaan julle daar ingooi as gevolg van hierdie Nicolaite groep wat gekom en julle ingestoot het. Want ek gaan julle laat sterf vir my saak, maar ek sal julle kroon van die lewe gee op daardie dag.
So don't, now watch. He said, if you notice, as we read this 10th verse, let me read it over again.
So many, nou let op, hy het gesê, nou let op wanneer ons hierdie 10de vers lees. Laat ek dit weer lees.
Fear none of these things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that you may be tried. And you shall have tribulation 10 days, but be thou faithful unto. Did you notice that's not until? Not until death,
but unto death. You get it?
Amen.
Be thou faithful unto death. See? And they did.
Vrees voor niks wat jy sal lei nie. Kijk, die duivel gaan sommige van julle in die gevangenis werp, zodat julle op die proef gestel kan word, en julle sal 10 dae lang verdrukking hê. Maar wees getrouw tot, het julle opgelet, dus niet totdat die dood nie, maar tot die dood toe. Begryp julle dit? Wees getrouw tot die dood toe, sien en hulle was.
Now he said, Satan, did you notice who he classed as the one that was doing it? Now this synagogue of Satan was the Nicolaitans, we know that, wasn't it?
Nou, hy het gesê, Satan, het julle opgelet wie hy geklassificeer het as die een wat het gedoen het? Nou, hierdie synagoge van Satan was die Nicolaïte. Ons weet het. Was dit nie?
There was an organization, a priesthood, that was rising up, that would make these people suffer. That would make these people suffer, and they were to be faithful to the gospel unto death.
Dan was dit een organisatie, een priesterdom wat opgestaan het, wat hierdie mense sou laat lei, en hulle moes getrouw bly aan die evangelie tot die dood toe.
Do you notice the marriage ceremony? Not until death do we part, but unto death do we part. See? Now, unto and until is different. Now, they were to be faithful to Christ unto death. Go right on down to death with it. Don't be afraid, for I'll give you a crown.
Het julle opgelet in 'n huwelik ceremonie? Nie totdat die dood ons skei nie, maar tot die dood ons skei sien. Nou totdat en tot is verskillend. Nou hulle moes getrouw wees aan Christus tot die dood toe. Gaan reguit af na die dood daarmee. Moenie bevrees wees nie, want ek sal jou 'n kroon gee.
Now, this 10 days that they talk of here, the 10 days, a day in the Bible represents a year. And the 10 days was the last 10 years of the reign of this D-I-O-C-L-E-A-T-I-O-N, Diocletian.
Nou hierdie 10 dae waarvan hulle hier praat, die 10 dae, 'n dag in die Bybel verteenwoordig 'n jaar, en die 10 dae van die laaste 10 jaar van die heerskappy van hierdie D-I-O-C-L-E-A-T-I-A-N-I-S. Diocletianus.
Diocletian. That was a great emperor that reigned in the last, well, there's several emperors reigned during the Ephesian church age, and Nero, I believe, was one.
Diocletianus, dit was daar die groot keiser wat regeer het in die laaste. Wel, daar was verskeie keisers wat regeer het gedurende die Efesiese kerktydperk. En Nero, glo ek, was een.
And this Diocletian here was the last one that reigned in the last 10 years, and he was the bloodiest persecutor of all of them.
En hierdie Diocletianus hier was die laaste een wat regeer het in die laaste 10 jaar, en hy was die bloeddorstigste vervolging van hulle allemaal.
He decided in with this group, and they murdered the Christians and killed them, they burned them, they did everything, and it was 10 years of the most bloody persecution.
Hy het ingeskakel met hierdie groep en hulle het die Christene vermoor, hulle het doodgemaak en hulle het hulle verbrand, hulle het alles gedoen, en dit was 10 jaar van die bloeddorstigste vervolging.
And his time and his reign was from 302 until 312. That ended the Smyrna age with the issuing in of Constantine. And he come in at 312. Constantine did.
En sy tyd in sy heerskappy was van 302 tot 312. Dit het Smyrna tydperk beëindig met die inkom van Constantine. En hy het ingekom in 312, het Constantine.
That was the 10 days of tribulations. And it started with Nero and ended up with Diocletian. And it started in, Nero was about AD 64 when Nero took the throne.
Dit was die 10 dae van die verdrukking, en dit het begin by Nero en geëindig met Diocletianus. En dit het begin by Nero was rondom 64 na Christus toe Nero die troon bestyg het.
Now, the 11th verse is a promise.
Now we'll have this just before closing. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death.
Nou, die 11e vers is een belofte. Nou, ons sal dit kry net voor afsluiting. Wie een oor het, laat om hoor wat die Gees aan die gemeente sê. Die wat oorwin, sal deur die tweede dood geen skade leen.
Now, I got to say something here. In order, if I think it my heart and don't say it, then I'm a hypocrite. See? I want you to notice something here in this scripture. And I think it was one of the biggest puzzles to me for so long until I found out. Now let's read that real close now. See?
Nou, ek moet iets hier sê so dat as ek dit dink my hart en dit nie sê nie, dan is ek een skynheilige sien. Ek wil hê julle moet iets oplet hier in die skrif. En ek dink dit was een van die grootste raaisels vir my vir so lang totdat ek uitgevind het. Nou laat ons dit baie aandagtig lees nou sien.
He that has an ear, in other words has an ear to hear, so it's open to the Spirit. Let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Now see, this same thing, this persecution and everything, comes every part of it, laps over in every church, the churches.
Wie oor het, met ander woorde, oor het om te hoor sien, dis oop vir die Gees. Laat hom hoor wat die Gees aan die gemeente sê. Nou sien, hier die selfde ding, hier die vervolging en alles kom, elke deel oor vleel in elke kerk, die kerke.
Spirit says to the churches, he that overcometh, in what church? Ephesians? Yep. All right. Smyrna? Yep. All of them. He that overcomes in all the churches shall not be hurt of the second death.
Hier sê aan die gemeentes, die wat oorwin, in wat kerk? Ephesiese? Ja goed. Smyrna? Ja, allemaal van hulle. Die wat oorwin in al die kerke, sal deur die tweede dood geen skade lei nie.
He in the Laodicean church that overcomes what? Overcomes the Nicolaitans, overcomes the things of the world,
Amen.
Overcomes these denominations,
Amen.
Overcomes these priesthoods,
Amen.
Overcomes everything of the world, and settles out and loves Christ,
Amen.
He'll not be heard of the second
Amen.
Death.
Hey, in die Laodiceese kerk, wat oorwin? Die Nicolaïte oorwin, die ding van die wereld oorwin, hierdie denominaties oorwin, hierdie priesterdomme oorwin, alles van die wereld oorwin en uitverkoop in Christus liefhet, julle sal nie deur die tweede dood skade lei nie.
Why? He's got eternal life.
Hallelujah.
Eternal life can't die.
Amen.
Jesus said, he that heareth of me has eternal life,
Amen.
Shall never die. I'll raise him up at the last day.
Hoekom, hy het ewige lewe. Ewige lewe kan nie sterf nie. Jesus het gesê, hy wat luister na my, het ewige lewe sal nooit sterf nie. Ek sal hom opwek in die laaste dag.
Now you're going to be many disagree with this, but I want you to think real hard before you make your decision. See? I'm going to say something now.
Nou, julle gaan baie wees wat verskil hiervan, maar ek wil hê julle moet baie goed dink voor julle besluit neem sien. Ek gaan nou iets sê.
That's the reason I don't believe that there is an eternal hell. There cannot be an eternal hell. Because if there ever was an eternal hell, there always was an eternal hell. Because eternal, there's only one form of eternal life. And that's what we're all striving for.
Dis waarom ek nie glo daar is 'n ewige hel nie. Daar kan nie ewige hel wees nie. Want as daar ooit 'n ewige hel was, dan was daar altyd 'n ewige hel, want ewig, daar is net een vorm van ewige lewe, en dis waarna ons almal streef.
And if you're going to burn forever and for eternity, then you'll have to have eternal life burning, and it'd be God burning.
Amen.
You can't have eternal hell. And the Bible plainly says that hell was created. Amen. And if it's created, it isn't eternal.
En as jy vir altyd gaan brand en vir ewigheid, dan sal jy ewige lewe moet laat brand, en dan sal dit God wees wat brand. Jy kan nie ewige lewe hê nie, en die Bybel sê duidelik dat hel geskape is. En as dit geskape is, is dit nie ewig nie.
Anything that's eternal never was created.
Amen.
It always was. It's eternal.
And the Bible says that hell was created for the devil and his angels.
Amen.
Hell was created. It isn't eternal. And I do not believe that a person will be eternally punished.
Enige iets wat ewig is, is nooit geskapen nie. Dit was altijd dus ewig. En die Bijbel sê dat jou geskapen was vir die devil en sy engele. Jou is geskapen en dit is nie ewig nie. En ek glo nie dat die persoon ewiglik gestraf sal word nie.
I believe that the Bible plainly states here that he that overcometh shall not be hurt by the second death. Now death, the word death comes from the, is this, is separation.
Ek glo dat die Bijbel duidelijk hier sê dat hy wat oorwin nie deur die tweede dood sal skade lei nie. Nou dood, die woord dood kan van die is hierdie, is scheiding.
Now, when we are separated from God in sin, we're already dead. The Bible said so. We're alienated from God. We're cut off. We're dead in sin and trespasses. We're alien to God and to His commonwealth. And then, when we receive God and have eternal life, we are His children and a part of Him.
Nou, wanneer ons geskei word van God in sonde, is ons alreeds dood. Die Bijbel het so gesê, ons is vervreemd van God, ons is afgesny, ons is dood in sonde en oortredinge, ons is vreemdelinge vir God en vir sy ryk. En dan, wanneer ons God ontvang en ewig lewe het, is ons sy kinders en 'n deel van hom.
My little boy there, Joseph, is part of me. No matter what he'd ever do, he might not have, if I was a great rich man and had a lot of inheritance, he might even inherit anything, but still he's a son. He's part of me. Sure, he's part of me.
My seentjie daar, Joseph is deel van my. Maak nie saak wat ek hy ooit doen nie. Hy mag nie hê, as ek 'n groot ryk man was en 'n groot erflating gehad het, mag hy selfs enige iets erf. Maar hy is steeds 'n seun. Hy is deel van my. Sekerlik, hy is deel van my.
Now, I can more deny him and I can deny myself because he's part of me. The blood test would show that he's mine. See? And the blood test shows whether you're God's or not.
Amen.
See? You're God's children and you have eternal life. But the soul that sinneth, that soul shall be separated. Is that right?
Amen.
Then it will be no more.
Nou, ek kan hom net so min ontken as wat ek myself kan ontken, want hy is deel van my. Die bloedtoets sal wys, hy is myne sien. En die bloedtoets wys of jy Godsin is of nie, sien. Julle is Godse kinders en julle het ewig lewe, maar die siel wat sondig, daardie siel sal geskei word. Is dit reg? Dan sal dit nie meer wees nie.
Now look, anything that had a beginning has an end. Because anything that had a beginning is a creation. But God was not created. He was always God. There's no place He was created, and the only way that we can ever have eternal life is to be part of that creation.
Nou kyk, enig iets wat 'n begin gehad het, het 'n einde, wat enig iets wat 'n begin gehad het, is 'n skepping. Maar God is nie geskape nie, Hy was altyd God. Daar is geen plek waar Hy geskape is nie, en die enigste manier wat ons ooit ewige lewe kan hê, is om deel van haar skepping te wees.
Glory! Oh, if you could see it, see what the Holy Ghost does for you. It's the Holy Ghost, the Creator Himself. God the Father, in the form of a Spirit, called Holy Ghost because it's upon the body called Jesus, His Son. That He created Jesus, the body, that's the reason it had to die.
Glory, o, as ons dit kon sien. Sien, wat doen die Heilige Gees vir jou? Dis die Heilige Gees, die Skepper self, God die Vader in die vorm van 'n Gees, namelijk Heilige Gees, want dit was op die liggaam, namelijk Jesus, sy Seun, wat hy Jesus geskaap het, die liggaam, dis hoekom dit moes sterf.
God dwelt in this human flesh, and the blood cell was broken, the life in the blood cell come back.
God het in hierdie menslike vlees gewoon, en die bloedsel is gebreek, en die lewe van die bloedsel het teruggekom.
That's the reason that the old worshipper in the Old Testament could not go away. He went away with the same condemnation that he had when he came. But in the New Testament, said Hebrews, that the worshipper once purged has no more conscience of sin.
Dis hoekom die ou aanbidder in die Ou Testament nie kon weggaan. Hy het teruggegaan met diezelfde veroordeling as wat hy gehad het toe hy gekom het. Maar in die Nieuwe Testament het die Hebreërs gesê dat die aanbidder wat eenmaal gereinig is, geen gewete van sonde meer het nie.
Now the Old Testament, they brought a lamb, he laid it down, put his hands up on the worshipper, priest cut the throat, he felt the bleeding and heard the bleeding of it, and it died, and he felt his little body stiffen out, and he was dead. He knew that ought to be him, the lamb took his place.
Nou die Old Testament, hulle het 'n lam gebring, hy het dit neergelees, sy hande daarop geplaas, die aanbidder, priester het die keel afgesny, hy het die bloeding gevoel, en die blaar daarvan gehoor. En dit het gesterf en hy het sy lichaampie voel stijf word en dit was dood. Hy het geweet dat behoort hy te wees, die lam het sy plek geneem.
The priest took the blood, put it on the altar and the smoke went up and it was a prayer of forgiveness for the world. And that animal life could not come back upon a human and coincide with the human spirit because it's animal spirit, animal life and human life. It couldn't do it.
Die priester het die bloed geneem, dit op die altaar geplaas en die rook het opgetrek en dit was 'n gebed van vergifnis vir die aan. En daar die diere lewe kon nie terug op 'n mens en ooreenstem met die menslike gees nie, omdat dit diere gees is. Diere lewe en menslike lewe, dit kon dit nie doen nie.
But when, that's the reason he went out with the same desire to sin. Same thing, come in for committing adultery and offer up his sacrifice and go back out the same thing in his mind. That's right.
Maar wanneer het dus hoekom hy uitgegaan het met dieselfde begeerte om te sondig dieselfde ding, ingekom het oorspel pleeg en sy offer geoffer en uitgegaan met dieselfde ding in sy gedagte, dis reg.
But here when the worshipper, oh church of God, don't fail to get this, the worshipper once truly walks up to the Son of God and by faith lays his hands upon him. Oh my.
Maar hier waar die aanbidder, ook kerk van God, moet dit nie mis nie. Die aanbidder wat waarlik eenmaal opstap na die Seun van God en deur geloof sy hande lê op hom, o goeiste.
Look there at his face, that spit hanging in his face. The blood running down his face. Feel the pains of my God, why has thou forsaken me? Oh brother, when you see what a price that died for you and who it was, Emmanuel, God, dying in your place.
Daar in sy gesig kyk met spoeg wat hang aan sy gesig, die bloed wat teen sy gesig afloop, die pyn voel van my God, waarom het u my verlaat, o broer, wanneer jy sien wat prys vir jou gesterf het, en wie dit was, Emmanuel, God wat in jou plek sterf.
Then what happens? The worshipper then, when that blood cell was broken, the Son of God, what made that blood cell?
Wat gebeur dan, die aanbidder dan, toe daar die bloedsel gebreek was in die Seun van God? Wat het daar die bloedsel gemaak?
What are you? You're one little cell that come from your father. The female does not have the hemoglobin. The female only produces the egg, the incubator she is to pack the brood.
Wat is jy? Jy is een celletjie van jou vader afgekom het. Die vroulike het nie die hemoglobin nie. Die vroulike bring net die eier voort die broeikas, sy moet die broeisel dra.
But the blood comes from the male, that's the reason the child takes the father's name. And then the woman married to a man takes his name on account of the children. She becomes an incubator for the child that she shall bear for the man. But like, as I said, a hen can lay an egg. But if she hasn't been with the male bird, it won't hatch.
Maar die bloed kom van die mannelik af, dus hoekom die kind die vader se van neem. En dan maar, die vrou wat met 'n man trou neem sy van, as gevolg van die kinders, sy word 'n broeikas vir die kind wat sy sal baar vir die man. Maar soos ek gesê het, 'n hen kan 'n eier lê, maar as sy nie by die mannetjie voel was nie, sal dit nie uitbroei nie.
That's the reason we got so many old cold formal churches today. They got on this Nicolaitan idea, got a bunch of nests full of rotten eggs and they never will hatch because they ain't...
Dis het ek gesê, dis waarom ons soveel ou koue formele kerke het vandag. Hulle het hierdie Nicolaïte idee aanvaar, het 'n klomp neste vol vrot eiers, en hulle sal nooit uitbroei nie, want hulle het nie.
You can do anything to them, call them bishops, deacons, and whatever, no, they'll never believe in signs following the believer, because they've never been with the mate, Jesus Christ.
Jy kan enig iets aan hulle doen, noem hulle biskoppe, die jakens, wat ook al, hulle sal nooit glo in tekens wat die gelowiges volg nie, want hulle was nooit by die maat Jesus Christus nie.
But if you ever get fertilized with that made of the power of God, when that blood cell was broke there on Calvary, and that life that was in there, teeny Jehovah, oh, it ought to be striking.
As jy ooit bevrug word met die maat van die krag van God, toe daar die bloedsel gebreek was daar op Golgotha, en daar die lewe wat daarin was, klein Jehovah, o, dit behoort treffend te wees.
You know, everybody's looking for a sign, aren't they? Everybody says, oh, show me a sign. The Jew said, show me a sign. Yeah. Let me give you a sign. God gave you a sign one time.
Julle weet, almal soek na teken. Nie waar nie, almal sê, o, wys my 'n teken. Die Jood het gesê, wys vir my 'n teken. Laat ek vir julle 'n teken gee. God het een keer vir julle 'n teken gegee.
They asked for a sign. The Israel asked for a sign. He told the prophet, I'll give them an everlasting sign.
Amen.
A virgin shall conceive.
Amen.
A virgin shall conceive and shall bring forth a son. Amen. He shall be called Emmanuel, God with us. The greatest sign that was ever given.
Hulle het gevra vir 'n teken. Die Israel het gevra vir 'n teken. Hy het vir die profeet gesê, ek sal vir hulle 'n ewige teken gee. 'N maag sal swanger word. 'N maag sal swanger word en sal 'n seun baar. Amen. Hy sal genoem word Immanuel, God met ons. Die grootste teken wat ooit gegee is.
When God, the creator of heavens and earth, made the solar system, stand out there at Mount Palmer, look through that scope yonder, and you can see 120 million years of light space.
Toe God die skepper van hemel en aarde die sonnestelsel gemaak het, staan daar buite by Berg Palomar en kyk deur haar teleskoop daarna, en jy kan 120 miljoen jaar van ligruimte sien.
Break that down in miles, and beyond that still moon, stars and worlds, and he made them all. Just blow them off his hands like that. Yes.
Breek dit af na myle en ander kant, dit is nog maan en sterre en werelde. En hy het hulle almal gemaak. Hulle net van sy hande af geblaas soos daar die jaar.
And that great creator became my savior.
Amen.
Come down to a little blood cell, not through a man, but come virgin to a woman. And took this little pollen from the woman and formed himself a little house and lived in it. Oh, it ought to be striking.
Daar die groot skepper het my verlosser geword. Afgekom na klein bloedselletjie, nie deur die mens nie, maar maagdelik na vrou gekom. En hy het hierdie stuifmeel van die vrou geneem en vir homself 'n huisie gevorm. En daarin gewoon, o, dit behoort treffend te wees.
Jehovah! Jehovah, over a pile of manure in a barn, crying.
Amen.
Jehovah, in a manger of straw.
Amen.
That's an everlasting sign.
Amen.
These big-headed people.
Jehovah, Jehovah bokant 'n mis op in 'n skuur wat huil. Jehovah in 'n krib van hooi. Dis 'n ewige teken, party van haar groot kop mense.
Jehovah God,
Amen.
A crying baby.
Amen.
Hallelujah. In a stinking stable. And then we think we're somebody.
Yeah.
Stick your nose up and rain it drowns you. And then go along thinking you're somebody.
Jehovah God, a heilende babakie. Hallelujah. In a stinkstal. En dan dink ons is iemand. Steek jou neus op. Dit sou reën. So dat jou verdrink en gaan dan rond en dink is iemand.
And Jehovah laying in a stable over a pile of manure crying like any little baby. It ought to be striking. That's a sign. God said, I'll give you an everlasting sign. That's a real sign.
En Jehovah wat in 'n stal lê bokant 'n mishoop wat huil soos 'n klein enige klein baba. Dit behoort treffend te wees. Dis 'n teken. God het gesê, ek sal vir julle 'n ewige teken gee. Dis 'n ware teken.
Jehovah playing as a boy.
Amen.
Jehovah. Jehovah working in a workshop. Sawing wood like a carpenter.
Amen.
Hallelujah. My, oh my. Jehovah washing the feet of fishermen.
Amen.
I'll give you a sign.
Jehovah wat speel as 'n seentjie. Jehovah wat werk in 'n werkswinkel wat hout saag soos 'n skrynwerker. Halleluja. Goeiste, o goeiste Jehovah wat die voete van die vissermanne was. Ek sal vir jou 'n teken gee.
Oh, but we have to have the clergy, you know, with the robes and all the collars and see, I'll give an everlasting sign.
O, maar ons moet die geestelikes hê, julle weet, en met die togas en al die koorde kra en sien o, ek sal vir julle 'n ewige teken gee.
Jehovah standing in the courtyard just spit on his face. Jehovah stretched up naked in a body between heavens and earth. He despised the shame of the cross. We have his statue there with a little rag around. Of course, that's just a sculpture. Did that? They stripped him naked.
Yes.
Yeah. Embarrassed him.
Jehovah wat in die binnenhoofd staan met die spoeg op sy gezicht. Jehovah nakend opgehees in een lichaam tussen die hemel en aarde. Hy het die skande van die kruis veracht. Ons het sy beeld daar met een klein lapje om hem. Natuurlijk was dit net die beeld over dit gedoen het. Hy het hom kaal uitgetrek, hom beskaam.
Oh, that bunch of hypocrites when that hour come. This is the day of man, the day of the Lord's a coming.
Amen.
Jehovah. Jehovah dying. Yes, nothing happened. Jehovah praying. Nothing happened.
Waar daar die klomp skyn heiliges wanneer haar uur aanbreek. Hier is die dag van die mens, die dag van die Here kom. Jehovah, Jehovah sterwend. Ja, niks het gebeur nie. Jehovah wat bid. Niks het gebeur nie.
That's right. It ought to be striking. That's an everlasting sign. That's a sign that all man would know. Then he died. Jehovah died. Then the earth began to shake.
Dis reg, dat behoort treffend te wees. Dis 'n ewige teken. Dis die teken dat alle mense sou weet. Toe hy gesterf het, Jehovah het gesterf. Toe het die aarde begin skud. O goeiste.
Then he rose up from the grave and ascended on high. Jehovah returning in the form of the Holy Ghost to live in his church among his people. Glory!
Toe hy opgestaan het uit die graf en opgevaar het in die hoogte, Jehovah wat terugkeer in die vorm van die Heilige Gees om in sy kerk te woon onder sy mense, glorie.
Jehovah walking down to the church discerning the thoughts of the mind. Jehovah healing the sick. Jehovah speaking through lips till the man has got no control of himself. Jehovah coming back in English and translating. You want a sign? Amen.
Jehovah wat afloop deur die kerk wat die gedagtes van die verstand onderskei. Jehovah wat die siekes genees, Jehovah wat spreek deur die lippe, tot hy die man geen beheer oor homself het nie. Jehovah wat terugkom in Engels en dit vertaal, wil julle 'n teken hê? Amen.
That's Jehovah come down to a prostitute. Rise her up where she's so low down to the dogs won't look at her. And wash her white as snow and give her a heart as pure. Oh my.
Daar Jehovah wat afkom na prostituut haar ophef waar sy so laag was dat die honde nie na haar wou kyk nie en haar wit was so sneeu en haar hart gee so suiwer soos 'n lelie. O goeiste.
Jehovah taking a drunkard laying here on the alley and the fly blows all over his mouth and making him preach the gospel out. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us.
Jehovah wat 'n dronkaard neem wat daar in die steeg lê en maaiers oral oor sy mond en hom die evangelie laat preek. Die bloed van Jesus Christus wat ons reinig.
When he was on earth, he went to the lowest city there was and to the lowest people there was and they gave him the lowest name there was. That's right.
Toe hy op die aarde was, het hy gegaan na die laagste stad wat daar was en na die laagste mense wat daar was. En hulle het vir hom die laagste naam gegee wat daar was, dis reg.
They treat him the worst and call him the worst name that could be called, Beelzebub, a devil. The lowest they could give him, man give him.
Hulle het hom die slegste behandel en hom die slegste naam genoem wat genoem kon word, Beelzebub, a devil. En die laagste wat hulle hom kon gee, het die mens hom gegee.
But God raised him up.
Amen.
And he give him a throne so high till he has to look down to see heaven. Amen. Glory. And give him a name above every name that's mentioned in heaven and earth, and all the family in heaven and earth name that him.
Maar God het hom verhef en het vir hom 'n troon gegee so hoog dat hy moet afkyk om die hemel te sien. Amen. Glorie. En vir hom 'n naam gegee bo elke naam wat genoem word in die hemel en in die aarde. En die hele familie in die hemel en aarde is vernoem na hom.
That's what man thought of him. That's what God thought of him. Oh God, let my thoughts be like yours. Yes, sir. Oh, precious name.
Dis wat die mens van hom gedink het. Dis wat God van hom gedink het. O God, laat my gedagtes soos U sin wees, Vader. Ja, meneer, o kosbare naam.
Now, he that believeth on me has eternal life. Now, if there's only one form of eternal life, and you get it, and we're seeking for it through Jesus Christ, that's God's life.
Nou, hy wat in my glo het ewige lewe. Nou, as daar net een vorm van ewige lewe is, en jy kry dit, ons soek daarna deur Jesus Christus, is dit God se lewe.
Then when that blood cell was broke on the Son of God, and that little Jehovah that was bottled up on the inside of this man called Jesus, when in him dwelt the fullness of the Godhead bodily.
Toe daardie bloedsel gebreek is op die Seun van God, daardie klein Jehovah wat opgebottel is aan die binnenkant van hierdie man genaamd Jesus, wanneer die volheid van die Godheid lichamelijk in hom gewoon het.
And now when we accept that blood for the remission of our sins, that spirit that was on not a man, but on God.
Amen.
Glory! The Bible said the blood of God.
Amen.
En nou, wanneer ons daardie bloed aanvaar vir die vergifnis van ons sondes, daardie gees wat nie op 'n man was nie, maar op God, glory, die Bybel het gesê, die bloed van God.
Amen.
Somebody said, remember, don't say that about the Jews, because he was a Jew, he wasn't a Jew.
Amen.
He was neither Jew nor Gentile, he was God.
Amen.
That's right.
Iemand het gesê, julle onthou, hy sê niks van die Jode nie, want hy was 'n Jood. Hy was nie 'n Jood nie, hy was nie 'n Jood of heiden nie, hy was God. Dis reg.
He was a created blood.
Amen.
God made it special, it was his own.
Amen.
And through that created blood, we accept it as our pardon because he died the death for us. That blood cell broke, releases that Holy Spirit to come back on us. And now we are sons and daughters of God. Through a birth of the Spirit.
Hy was 'n geskape bloed. God het dit spesiaal gemaak. Dit was sy eie. En deur daardie geskape bloed aanvaar ons dit as ons kwytskelding, omdat hy die dood gesterf het vir ons. Daardie bloedsel het gebreek, stel daardie Heilige Gees vry om terug te kom op ons. En nou is ons seuns en dogters van God deur die geboorte van die Gees.
Yeah.
Then the life that was God's, which didn't have no beginning, or neither will it ever has an end, is mine and yours by the grace of God in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
There you are.
Dan is die lewe wat God sin was, wat geen begin gehad het of nooit ooit sal dit 'n einde hê nie, myne en joune deur die genade van God in Jesus Christus. Daar het julle dit.
Now, hell, we'll go back to that a while. I tell you that if there cannot be, I do believe in a burning hell. Yes, sir. The Bible said so, the lake of fire. Now, but that cannot be an everlasting, cannot be an eternal.
Nou ja, ons sal 'n rukkie teruggaan daarna toe. Ek sê julle dat daar nie kan wees. Ek glo wel in 'n brandende hel. Ja, meneer, die Bybel het so gesê, die poel van vuur. Nou, maar dit kan nie 'n ewig gewees nie.
It could be, the Bible never says it's eternal. It says the everlasting hell. Don't say the word eternal. It says an everlasting hell. Now, it's prepared for the devil and his angels, an everlasting hell, not an eternal one.
Dit kan wees, die Bybel sê nooit dis ewig nie. Dit sê ewig durende hel. Sê nie die woord ewig nie, dit sê ewig durende hel. Nou, dit is voorberei vir die duivel en sy engele, 'n ewig durende hel, nie 'n ewige een nie.
Now, after that soul may be tormented there for its doings for 10 million years, for all I know. I don't know what everlasting might be in God's sight. It might be for 5 minutes, it might be for 1 million years, it might be for 10 million years, but there will come a time when that soul will cease to be.
Nou ja, daar die siel mag daar gepeinig word vir sy dade vir 10 miljoen jaar vir al wat ek weet. Ek weet nie wat ewigdurend in Godse oë mag wees nie. Dit mag wees vir 5 minute, dit mag wees vir 'n miljoen jaar, dit mag wees vir 10 miljoen jaar, maar daar sal 'n tyd aanbreek wanneer daar die siel nie meer sal bestaan nie.
Here's what the Bible said. He that overcometh shall not be hurt by the second death.
Hier is wat die Bybel gesê het, sien, die wat oorwin sal deur die tweede dood geen skade ly nie.
The first death is separating from our loved ones. We're going the presence of God, never out of His presence. See? Now, if there's a second death, then it has to be the death of the soul.
Die eerste dood is om van ons geliefdes geskei te wees. Ons gaan in die teenwoordigheid van God nooit uit sy teenwoordigheid uit nie. Sien? Nou as daar 'n tweede dood is, dan sal dit die dood van die siel moet wees.
And then he that overcomes the world, overcomes the things of the world, has eternal life and shall not be touched by the second death. There you are. Eternal life.
Dan het hy wat die wêreld oorwin of die dinge van die wêreld oorwin, ewige lewe en sal nie deur die tweede dood geraak word nie. Daar het jy dit ewige lewe.
But the sinner, the Bible said, the woman that lives in pleasure is dead while she is alive. Is that right? The soul that sinneth, it shall surely die. What is die? Completely separate. No more. See?
Maar die sonder die Bybel het gesê, die vrou wat in losbandigheid lewe is dood terwyl sy lewe. Dis reg. Die siel wat sondig, dit sal sekerlik sterwe. Wat is sterf? Totaal skei nie meer nie, sien?
Now, it's cut off, is right. It's cut off, there's no more to it. How long will it be to take that? It'll go down through the same process it come in, and it'll come to a place till there will neither be nothing left of it. It'll just go back from everywhere it's made out of.
Nou, dis afgesny, dis reg. Dis afgesny, daar's niks meer daarvan nie. Hoe lang sal dit wees om dit te doen? Dit sal afgaan deur dieselfde proses waarmee dit ingekom het en dit sal kom by 'n punt tot waar daar nie meer enige iets daarvan oor is nie. Dit sal net teruggaan na waar dit ook al gemaak is.
We can take the cell and break the cell to one cell to another cell. You come down to the first cell, break into that cell, then you got the chemistry of the blood. You come into different chemistries of the blood and then you come down to a little part in that cell. It's life.
Want so 'n sel kon neem die sel afbreek na een sel, na nog 'n sel, totdat jy so kom by die eerste sel. En daar die sel inbreek, dan het jy die chemiese samenstelling van die bloed. Jy kom in verskillende chemiese samenstellings van die bloed in, en dan kom jy af na die klein deeltjie in daar die sel. Dis lewe.
You can't find that, don't know nothing about it. Now that life will finally come to a spot till it is no more. What are the chemistry of that life? I don't believe it has any chemistry. It'll be spiritual.
Hulle kan dit nie vind nie. Hulle weet niks daarvan nie. Nou daardie lewe sal uiteindelik kom by die plek waar dit nie meer is nie, wat die chemiese samenstelling van daardie lewe ook al is. Ek glo nie dit het enige chemiese samenstelling nie. Dit sou geestelik wees.
And then in that finally it'll completely separate and be no more. That's what the Bible said. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. And they that overcome in these church ages here shall not be hurt by the second death. The body dies first, the soul dies next. And it will be no more. See? As you believe that's the Bible, it says it?
En dan daarin sal dit uiteindelik heeltemal skei en nie meer wees nie. Dis wat die Bybel gesê het, die siel wat sondig, dit sal sterf. En hulle wat oorwin in hierdie kerktydperke hier, sal deur die tweede dood geen skade ly nie. Die liggaam sterf eerste, die siel sterf volgende, en dit sal nie meer wees nie. Sien, dis, glo julle, dis die Bybel wat dit sê?
Now remember, if hell is eternal, then the Bible's wrong when it said hell was created. And then if a man's going to burn for eternity in hell, then he'd have to have eternal life to be conscious to burn. Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, how many forms of eternal life is there?
One.
Amen. That's right. It's one eternal life.
No and oh, as die hel ewig is, dan is die Bybel verkeerd toe dit gesê het, hel is geskape. En dan as een mens vir ewig gaan brand in die hel, dan sou hy ewige lewe moes hê om by sy bewussin te wees om te brand. Is dit reg? Wel, hoeveel vorms van ewige lewe is daar? Een, dis reg, net een ewige lewe.
Now don't go away and say, Brother Branham don't believe in hell. Brother Branham does believe in hell. The Bible teaches there's a hell. Just as sure as there's a place for rest, there's a place of punishment.
Dan moet nie weggaan en sê, Brother Branham glo nie in die hel nie. Brother Branham glo wel in die hel. Die Bybel leer dat daar een hel is. Net so seker as wat daar een plek van rus is, is daar een plek van straf.
And God will certainly make a soul that sins against him be punished. And for rejecting Jesus Christ as your Savior, you certainly will be punished for it. But there'll be a time when you'll be no more. But how many million years that'll take for you to go back to that, I don't know.
En God sal beslis een siel wat teen hom sondig laat straf. En om Jesus Christus as jou verlosser te verwerp, sal jy beslis gestraf word daarvoor. Maar daar sal een tyd wees waar jy nie meer sal wees nie. Maar hoeveel miljoen jaar dit vir jou sal neem om terug te gaan daarna, weet ek nie.
But sometime you're a time being until you're born again, then you're an eternal being. And the only way you can get it is have part of God in you being eternal life. Can you see it?
Yeah.
Certainly. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches.
Maar een of ander tyd, jy is 'n tydswese totdat jy wedergebore is, dan is jy ewig gewees, en die enigste manier wat jy dit kan kry, is om deel van God in jou te hê as ewige lewe. Kan julle dit sien? Sekerlik. Wie jy oor het, laat hom hoor wat die Gees aan die gemeente sê.
I love him, don't you? I'm so glad to have eternal life. That doesn't bother me anymore, because if we have eternal life now, and I know that, and I trust that everybody will have it, all of us.
Ek het om lief, en julle, ek is so bly om ewige lewe te hê, dit pla my nie meer nie, omdat ons nou ewige lewe het. Ek weet dit, en ek vertrou dat almal dit sal hê, almal van ons.
Irenaeus, yes, I had a note here on Irenaeus, about the read this history, that the reason Irenaeus was chosen is because that he had the signs of the Pentecostal original church following him.
Irenaeus, ja, ek het 'n nota hier oor Irenaeus gehad, oor om hier die geskiedenis te lees, dat die rede waarom Irenaeus gekies is, is omdat hy tekens van die Pinkster oorspronkelike kerk gehad het, wat hom gevolg het.
Now, if God, how many believes that the church began at Pentecost?
Amen.
All right. How many believes that God endorsed the church at Pentecost?
Amen.
All right, sir?
Nou, as God, hoeveel glo dat die kerk begin het by Pinkster? Goed, hoeveel glo dat God die kerk goedgekeur het by Pinkster. Goed, meneer.
Then if that was God's first church, and that's what he called a church, and he's the vine now, we're the branches, if the vine ever puts forth another branch, what will it be? Pentecostal.
Yeah. Dan as dit God se eerste kerk was, en dis wat hy 'n kerk genoem het, en hy is nou die wingerdstok, ons is die lote, as die wingerdstok ooit weer nog 'n loot voorbring, wat sal dit wees? Pinkster, ja.
Now, maybe not the name. Now, we got names of Pentecost, but that's no more than Methodist, Baptist, Presbyterian, Pentecostal. That don't mean a thing. See, that's just a name.
Nou, miskien nie by naam nie, ons het name van Pinkster, maar dis niks meer as Methodist, Baptist, Presbyterian, Pinkster nie. Dit beteken niks nie, sien, dis net 'n naam.
But as long as you got a Pentecostal experience in your heart, Pentecost in your soul, giving you eternal life, then God has promised you that you'll never be touched with the second death. That you got eternal life and can't be touched with the second death. See?
Maar solank jy 'n Pinkster ondervinding in jou hart het, Pinkster in jou siel, wat jou ewige lewe gee, dan het God jou beloof dat jy nie deur die tweede dood geraak sal word nie, dat jy ewige lewe het en nie deur die tweede dood geraak kan word nie. Sien?
Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. Now don't grieve it. Do things that's wrong. If you do, you'll pay for it. Because the Bible said, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed until the day of your redemption. Is that right? Grieve not the Holy Spirit.
Jy het, yes, bedroef nie die Heilige Gees van God nie. Nou moet nie dit bedroef dinge doen wat verkeerd is nie. As jy sal betaal daarvoor in die Bybel het gesê, bedroef nie die Heilige Gees van God, waardeur jy verseël is tot die dag van jou verlossing. Is reg, bedroef nie die Heilige Gees nie.
Oh, it's going to be a wonderful day some of these times. To show you that the resurrection is going to be universal, there will be two in the field, and I'll take one, and two in the bed, and I'll take one. See? It'll be the night one place and daylight on the other side of the earth. It'll be a universal resurrection, that rapture.
O, dit gaan 'n wonderlike dag wees, een oggend een van hierdie tye. Om julle te wys die opstanding gaan universeel wees, daar sal twee op 'n land wees, en ek sal een neem, en twee in 'n bed, en ek sal een neem. Sien, dit sal nag wees in een plek en daglig aan die ander kant van die aarde. Sal 'n universele opstanding wees daardie wegraping.
The trumpet of God shall sound, and every one of these, of this little church, here, 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 and even that little bunch that went through there, come out here, here, here.
Die besein van God sal blaas in elkeen van hierdie klein kerke hier, 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 en selfs daardie klein groep wat daar deurgegaan het en uitgekom het hier, hier, hier.
When that virgin, when she's seen in the seventh watch, that now remember, there were seven virgins, is that right? Five virgins, went out, ten virgins, went out to meet the Lord, five was wise and five was foolish, is that right?
Toe daarie maag, toe sy gesien het in die sewende waak, dat daar was sewe maagde, dit is het recht, ook bedoel vyf maagde, tien maagde het uitgegaan om die Here te ontmoet, vyf was wees en vyf was dwaas, is dit recht?
And now in the watches though, there were seven watches, and at the end of the seventh watch, some slept from this watch, this one, at the seventh watch, there was a voice went out, behold the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him.
Nou in die wake echter, daar was sewe wake, en aan die einde van die sewende waak, party het geslaap vanaf hierdie waak, hierdie een hier, en daar die sewende waak, wat daar 'n stem wat uitgegaan, en kyk die bruidegom kom, gaan julle uit hom tegemoet.
And they rose and trimmed their lamps, and all these others rose down to here. Oh, won't that be a wonderful time?
En hulle het opgestaan en hulle lampe geknip, en al hierdie ander het hierdeur opgestaan. O, sal dit nie 'n wonderlike tyd wees nie? O, ons het altyd lekker gesin, dis 'n wonderlike tyd vir jou, wat 'n wonderlike tyd vir my, as ons almal gereed op Jesus ons koning kan wag, wat 'n wonderlike tyd sal dit wees.
Let's see if we can sing it.
Hier, kom ons kyk of ons dit kan sing.
A wonderlike tyd vir jou, a wonderlike tyd vir my,
as ons almal gereed op Jesus ons koning kan wag, wat 'n wonderlike tyd sal dit wees.
Won't it be wonderful?
Sou dit nie wonderlik wees nie?
Oh, won't it be wonderful there, having no burdens to bear, joyously singing with heart bells all ringing, oh, won't it be wonderful there?
Hoe is dit nie wonderlik daar, sonder om laste te dra, van vreugde te sing en hartsklokke wat lei, hoe is dit nie wonderlik daar?
How many of you knows that you'll get home? How many knows you'll go out that door? You don't know. How many knows if you do go out, you will come in again? You cannot tell. So don't let this night fail. Don't you fail God in this night. For this might be the last night that you'd have a time or a chance.
Hoeveel van julle weet of julle by die huis sal kom? Hoeveel weet of julle by daardie deur sal uitkom? Julle weet nie. Hoeveel weet as julle wel uitkom, julle sal weer inkom? Julle kan nie sê nie, so moenie dat hierdie aand faal nie. Moet julle nie God faal in hierdie aand nie, want hierdie mag die laaste aand wees, wat julle 'n tyd of 'n kans sal hê.
Who are you anyhow? Where'd you come from? Where are you going? The only book in the world can tell you what it is this blessed old Bible here. And that's the Bible that we believe in, that's the God that we believe in.
Wie is jy in elk geval? Waar het jy vandaan gekom? Waarheen is jy op pad? Die eerste boek in die wêreld wat jou kan sê wat dit is hierdie geseënde ou Bybel hier. En dis die Bybel waarin ons glo, dis die God waarin ons glo.
And if you're not into that bride, into this little bunch of minorities way down here today, being squeezed out by creeds and denominations and so forth, if you're not in that little group, now you don't have to join this tabernacle, you don't have to join anything, you just have to be born into that kingdom.
En as julle nie in daardie breed is nie, in hierdie klomp minderhede, hier ver onder vandag wat uitgedrukt wordt door geloofsblijdenis en denominaties en so voort, as jy nie in daardie klein groepie is nie, nou jy hoef nie by hierdie tabernakel aan te sluit nie, jy hoef nie by enig iets aan te sluit nie, jy moet net in daardie koninkryk ingebore word.
Now, if you want your fellowship in the Methodist, Baptist, Presbyterian, wherever you want it, that's up to you. See, you put your fellowship with anybody you want to. But I'll tell you one thing, when you're born again, you're birds of a feather.
Nou, as jy jou gemeenskap wil hê in die Methodiste, Baptiste, Presbyteriaanse, waar jy ook al wil, hang dit van jou af. Sien, plaas jy jou gemeenskap by enige een wat jy wil, maar ek sal vir jou een ding sê, wanneer jy wedergebore is, jy weet, voels van eende se vere, goeiste.
Someone asked me one time, said, Brother Bram, you told them people going back to Methodist Church. I said, sure. Let them throw them out. They had no place to go. So, let us go on. So go on back. Won't be very long. Won't be very long. They'll be right back again.
Iemand het vir my een keer gevraag gesê, Broer Brenham, jy het vir daardie mense gesê, gaan terug na die Methodiste kerk toe. En gesê, sekerlik, laat hulle uitgooi. En hulle sal geen plek hê om na toe te gaan nie. So, dan sal ons sien. Dis doodreg, gaan maar terug. Dit sal nie baie lang wees nie, julle sien. Sal nie baie lang wees nie, hulle sal net weer reguit terugkom.
You know, one time in the ark, a place of safety, Noah, there was a big flood come, and so Noah turned the crow out of the ark, and he just went on cawing and looking around. Well, he was satisfied, because he was a vulture to begin with.
Julle weet, een keer in die Noah ark, die plek van veiligheid, Noah, daar het een groot vloed gekom. So het Noah die kraai losgelaat uit die ark, en het aanhou kraai en omkyk, wel hy was tevrede, want hy was 'n aasvoel om mee te begin.
He could fly from one old dead carcass and eat a belly full off of this mule and go down this this old sheep and eat a belly full off of him and something else was just all kind of old dead carcasses laying around.
Hy kon vlieg van een ou dooie karkas en 'n maag vol eet van hierdie muil en soontoe gaan op hierdie ou skaap en 'n maag vol van hom eet en iets anders, waar daar net allerhande ou dooie karkasse rondgelê.
So the crow would just sit down there, caw around, boy, I'm having me a jubilee all by myself, just cawing away.
So die kraai het net daar gaan sit en rondgekraai, jong, ek hou net 'n fees op my eie, net aan die kraai.
But when they turn the little dove out, he's a different nature.
Yeah.
That stink he couldn't stand. Why? A dove hasn't got any gall. He's the only bird that doesn't have a gall. He couldn't digest it. So the only thing he could do was get right back to the ark and beat on the door.
Maar toe hy die duivel losgelaat het, hy het ander geaard het gehad. Daar die stank, hy kon dit nie verdier nie. Hoekom? Die duivel het nie 'n gal nie. Hy is die enigste voël wat nie 'n gal het nie. Hy kon dit nie verteer nie. So die enigste ding wat hy kon doen is reguit terug na die ark en aan die deur klop.
Just go anywhere you want to. The only thing I'm asking you to do is just come into the kingdom.
Amen.
And I know where you'll go. You won't be able to stand it anymore, brother. You say, I've crossed the separating line. I've left this world behind. Yes, sir, it sure is.
Gaan net na enige plek wat jy wil. Enigste ding wat ek julle vra om te doen is net om in die koninkryk in te kom. En ek sal weet waar naartoe julle sal gaan. Jy sal nie meer kan uithou nie, broer. Jy sal sê, ek het oor die skeidslyn gegaan en ek het hierdie wêreld agtergelaat. Ja, meneer, dit is beslis.
Hulle
was vergaderd in die boortvertrek, gebed in sy naam.
They were baptized with the Holy Ghost and power for service for deeds. Now, what he did for them that day, he'll do for you the same. I'm so glad that I can say it's one of them. Aren't you?
Is julle nie?
One of them. It's one of them.
I'm so glad that I can say it's one of them.
Hallelujah.
One of them. It's one of them. It's so glad I can say it's one of them.
How many is glad of that tonight?
Oh,
hoeveel is bly daaroor vanaand, o goeiste?
Come, my brother, seek this blessing that will cleanse your heart from sin. that will start the joy bells ringing and will keep your soul on flame. Oh, it's burning out within my heart. Oh, glory is me. I'm so glad that I can say it's one of Him. It's in front of Him. It's in front of Him. It's a glad that I can say it's in front of Him. Hallelujah. It's in front of Him. It's in front of Him. It's a glad that I can say it's in front of Him.
Now, while we sing this next verse, I want you to shake hands like you do each night. All the Methodists and Baptists and Presbyterian, shake hands with one another and even be friendly enough to treat each other as chewing gum if you can. Now, just be real, real friendly. Be sociable now while we sing it.
Nou, terwijl ons hier die volgende vers zingen, wil ik heel jullie met handschud, zoals jullie elke aan doen, al die Methodisten, Baptisten en Presbyterianen, schud handen met elkaar en wees zelfs vriendelijk genoeg om elkaar zo koog om te koog als jullie kan. Nou, wees net baie, baie vriendelijk, wees gezellig nou, terwijl ons dit zingt. It's a glad that I can say it's in front of Him.
Though these people may not learn to be or boast of worldly fame, they have all received their Pentecost baptized in Jesus' name. And they're telling no more war and wine. His power is yet the same.
It's a glad that I can say I'm
wild. Now let's really sing it.
Dan laat ons het rechtig zingen.
Oh, in van Him, in van Him. It's so glad that I can say, in van Him, in van Him, in van Him. It's so glad that I can say, in van Him.
Would you be willing to be a martyr for Him, Mr. Marion? If it come to the spot that you had to face death or take it back, would you face it? Yes, sir.
Hallelujah.
Oh, God, it would be a pleasure.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir. That's where I want to go, right in the pulpit. That's right.
So jy bereid wees om 'n martelaar te wees vir hom saam met Smirnese? As dit kom by 'n punt waar jy dood moet trotseer of dit verloon, sou jy dit trotseer? Ja, meneer, o God, dit sou 'n plesier wees. Ja, meneer, dis hoe ek wil gaan, reg in die preekstoel, dis reg.
I thought I got it and was going to get it in Germany here not long ago. Oh, they was going to shoot me through a night scope and German soldiers run all around me and help back like that. I thought, what a wonderful thing it would be to die for my Lord right here on the field. Oh, my. What a wonderful thing.
En ek het gedink, ek het dit gekry. En hulle sou dit in Duitsland kry hier nie lank gelede nie. O, hulle sou my skiet deur 'n nagteleskoop en die Duitse soldate het oral om my gehardloop en gekeer soos daarie. En gedink, wat 'n wonderlike ding sou dit wees om vir my Here te sterf reg hier op die veld. O, goeieste, wat 'n wonderlike ding.
Well, let me sing you a little song, can I? Have you got time for just a little bit of one? I can't sing it, I'm talking. Oh, I've always wanted to sing. And some of these days when you get over to your lovely big home up there in paradise, way down at the end of the woods down there where Russell Creech and I'll be for this hunt, you know.
Wel, laat ek vir julle 'n klein liedjie sing. Kan ek? Het julle tyd vir net 'n kleintjie? Goed. Ek kan dit nie sing nie. Ek praat dit. O, ek wou altyd sing. En een van hierdie dae, wanneer julle kom by julle pragtige groot huis daarbo in die paradys, ver onder aan die einde van die woude daaronder, waar ek en Russell Creech sal wees vir hierdie jag, julle weet.
Way down in the woods is a little cabin where that Brother Neville sings about. Yeah. Build me a cabin in the corner. Yeah. I thought he's talking about my place.
Hallelujah.
The glory land.
Ver onder aan die onderkant van die woude is daar 'n klein hutjie daar oor kan waarvan Brother Neville sing. Bou vir my 'n hutjie in die hoek. Ek het gedink hy praat van my plek in die heerlikheid.
One of these mornings when you walk out on your great porch over there and look around like that, way down there in the corner, you hear somebody singing, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. You say, well, bless God, old Brother Branham made it.
Een van hierdie morgens, wanneer jy uitstap op jou grootstoep daar oor kan en omkyk soos daar, ver in die hoek, sal jy iemand oorsing. Genade onbeskryflik groot, hoe so die klank, wat die ellendeling soos ek gered het. Jy sê, wel prijs God, o broer Branham het dit gemaak.
There he is. You're standing over there right now singing Amazing Grace. It'll be Amazing Grace that brought me there. That's right.
Daar is hy, ek hoor hom daar oor kan staan net nou en sing genade onbeskryflik groot. Dit sal genade onbeskryflik groot wees wat my daar naartoe gebring het, dis reg. Maar dit drip van die bloed, ja.
Yes, that's why I'm preaching this.
Dis hoekom ek hierdie preek.
Dit drip van die bloed.
Hier die Heilige Geest Evangelie.
Is dripping with blood. The blood
van die disciples. Gesterf vir die waarheid. Hier die Heilige Geest Evangelie. Blij drip van die bloed. Die eerste het om sterven. Die Heilige Geest plan. Was Johannes die dripper. Maar het gesterf soos een man. Dan volgt hier Jesus. Gekruisig is hy. Hy geleer die Geest om mense van sonde bevry. Daar is Petrus en Paulus en Johannes van God. Hy het hulle levens geoffer. Daar die evangelie kon skyn. Hulle het al bloed vermeng. Soos die profete van oud. Dat die ware woord van God eerlijk kon blij. Daar siel onder die altaar, hier die martelaar, wat ek hoe lang voor die Heere hulle straf, wat die verkeerde doen.
Listen, quickly.
Luister vinnig, maar daar gaan om wees, wat hulle levensbloed slaat, voor die Heilige Geest Evangelie en sy rooi vloed. Dit drip van die bloed, ja, dit drip van die bloed. Hier die Heilige Geest Evangelie, drip van die bloed, die bloed van die disciples, gesterf voor de waarheid. Hier die Heilige Geest Evangelie, blij drip van die bloed.
Oh, there's going to
Yea, I say unto thee, my people, as the servant of the living God has brought forth his word unto thee this night, I say unto thee that the hour is upon the world. Yea, I speak unto thee, my people, that thou might be prepared. Yea, that thou might search thine heart, yea, saith the Lord. For I say that around the world this hour, there are many evil spirits now moving in high places. Yea, there are being things now prepared, saith the Almighty God, that shall bring these things to pass that my servant has spoke about. And I speak unto thee, my people, that when that hour has fully come, yea, when I shall bring these things to pass, yea, when thou shalt be demanded to make decisions in thine heart as to what thou would do, I say unto thee this night, wilt thou stand for the truth? Yea, wilt thou believe me, saith the Almighty God? Wilt thou purpose in thine heart to follow me, even as I paved the way for thee? And I say unto thee, my sons and daughters, tonight, be thou not discouraged when I say there are dark days that lie before thee. But I speak unto thee that thou might take courage, for I shall visit my people with great power. I shall vindicate my works, saith the Lord. I shall prove my people, for I say unto thee that I shall try them and I shall perfect them, and they shall know that I am the great Almighty God that has redeemed them, saith the Lord.
Amen.
I say unto thee, my people, this night, that as I have spoken again this evening unto thee, thou must search thine heart. Thou must recognize me this night, for I come into thy midst to bring thee these tidings, not to frighten thee, for I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I walk among thee this day.
Glory.
I say unto thee, my people, that thou should persevere in faith, that thou should lay aside these fancies and these feelings for personal affections, that thou should set thine heart upon thy God, that thou should depart from foolishness, that thou should put these human ways away from thee, that thou should turn unto my spirit and allow me to glorify my name through thy being. I say unto thee this night, be zealous and turn from thy foolishnesses. Cast aside thy fear, for I am thy God that watches over thee this night, and I, mine eyes shall run to and fro. As I have spoken, so will I perform it even unto the end. Therefore, look unto me, and believe me, and repent from thy wickedness, and from thine unbelief, and from thy fears, and come unto me, and serve me. Thus saith the Spirit of the living God.
Glory. Amen. Ja.
Amen. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches.
Amen. Wie oor het, laat hem hoor wat die Gees aan die gemeente sê.
Let him leave.
Worship now. See what he'll do. If you have never loved him before, would you want to love him now? Would you stand up and recognize him, take him as your Savior?
Aanbid nou, kyk wat hy sal doen. As jy hom nog nooit tevore lief gehad het nie, sal jy hom nou wou lief hê? Sal jy opstaan en hom erken, hom as jou verlosser aanneem?
God bless you, brother.
God seën jou, broer.
En
someone else will stand say, I want him right, I want to love him.
Iemand anders sal staan sê, ek wil hom hê, net nou, ek wil hom lief hê.
God bless you back there, young lady.
God seën jou, sister. God seën jou daar achter, jong dame.
He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the church.
Je oor het, laat hem hoor wat die Gees aan die kerk sê.
Father, as you see these three standing to their feet, oh God, I pray thee to be merciful, oh eternal one.
and to give to them pardon of every sin and salvation in the Holy Spirit in their life, that they'll not be touched by the second death.
Ons hemelse Vader, soos U hierdie drie sien staan op hulle voete, o God, bid ek dat U genadig sal wees, o ewige een, en om aan hulle vergifnis van elke sonde te gee en verlossing, die Heilige Gees in hulle lewe, dat hulle nie deur die tweede dood geskaad sal word nie.
They realize, Lord, tonight, as they stand there, that there's something near at hand. The Holy Spirit has given warning to see the Spirit of God fall among people, see it work just according to the Scriptures, just the three messages, and close off. Oh God, a message to each person.
Hulle besef, Here, vanavond, soos hulle daar staan, dat daar iets baie nabij is. Die Heilige Gees het gewaarsku om die Gees van God te sien val onder mense, dit te sien werk, net volgens die Skrifte, net die drie boodskappe en afsluit. O God, 'n boodskap in elke persoon.
Now, Father, we pray Thee to be merciful. Let that precious Spirit stay in our midst. May we reverence it, God. Grant it. Take these souls into Thy custody, Father. They are the fruits of the message tonight. And the message from the Holy Spirit that was spoken among us.
Nou, Vader, ons bid dat U genadig sal wees. Laat daar die kostbare Gees in ons midde bly. Mag ons dit eerbiedig, God, skenk dit. Neem hierdie siele onder U sorg, Vader. Hulle is die vrugte van die boodskap vanavond en van die boodskap van die Heilige Gees wat onder ons gespreek is.
And we ask, Father God, that You will be with them all the days of their life. And may in the world without end, may we meet them in there saved by the blood and grace of Christ. We give them to Thee now, Father. Fill them with Thy Holy Spirit. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
En ons vra, Vader God, dat U met hulle sal wees al die dae van hulle lewe en mag in die wêreld sonder einde, mag ons hulle daar binne ontmoet, gered deur die bloed en genade van Christus. Ons gee hulle nou vir U, Vader, vul hulle met U Heilige Gees, want ons vra dit in Jesus se naam. Amen.
God bless you, my brother. And everyone who's near those people that were standing, Christians, shake their hands when they sit down. Give them, wish them Godspeed.
God seën hulle, my broers, wie ook al nabij daardie mens is wat gestaan het. Christen, skittel handel wanneer hulle gaan sit, gee hulle, wens hulle God se seën toe.
See how obedient the Holy Spirit is, how it does it right at the end. See, the Bible said, let them that speak with tongues be by two, or not the most, but three, you see. The message, not while I was speaking, after it was all over. That's the way it's supposed to be.
Amen.
Everybody real reverent, listen what the Spirit says. Then what happened? Sinners raised up to repent. Oh, thank the Holy Spirit itself. Not getting it even through the Word has come and made manifestation.
Sien hoe gehoorsam die Heilige Gees is, hoe dit reg aan die einde doen, sien? Die Bijbel het gesê, laat hulle wat in tale spreek, twee wees of nie hoogstens drie. Julle sien die boodskap nie terwyl ek gepreek het nie. Nadat dit alles verby was, dis hoe dit veronderstel is om te wees, almal baie eerbiedig en luister wat die Gees sê. Toe wat het gebeur, sondaars het opgestaan om te bekeer, o, dink die Heilige Gees self, dit nie gekry nie, selfs deur die woord gekom en gemanifesteer.
I know some of these people are speaking in tongues. I know all three of them had spoke. And I know the ones that gave interpretations. I know their life is sinless before God.
Ek ken party van hierdie mense wat in tale praat. Ek ken al drie van hulle wat gepraat het. En ek ken diegene wat die uitleg gegee het. Ek weet hulle lewens is sondeloos voor God.
Brother Neville, you're our pastor, a Methodist minister. That's a Methodist minister sitting here. Receive the Holy Ghost. Judy over here, Brother Jackson, another Methodist preacher, receive the Holy Ghost. That's right. With a gift of tongues and interpretations.
Broer Neville hier, ons pastoor, een Methodiste prediker. Dis een Methodiste prediker waar het sit die Heilige Gees ontvang het. Juni, hier oor kan Broer Jackson, nog een Methodiste prediker, die Heilige Gees ontvang het. Dis recht, met een gave van taal en uitleg.
You notice how we have the church, everyone reverent, God speaking. You see how He speaks just exactly according to the Bible? One, the message don't get over just right, He speaks it again, but He won't speak over three times.
Julle let op hoe ons kerk ook almal eerbiedig God wat praat. Julle sien hoe Hy net precies volgens die Bybel spreek. 1. Die boodskap net nie reg oorkom nie, spreek hy dit weer. Maar hy sal nie meer as drie keer spreek nie.
See,
according to the scriptures there. See, he'll give that message. He never entangles it. For the spirit of the prophets is subject to the prophet. Everything listens and quietly. Now that's the way the church should be in order.
Sien volgende skrifte daar sien, hy sal haar die boodskap gee, hy verstrengel dit nooit, want die gees van die profeet is onderworpen aan die profeet. Alles luister en stil, en dis hoe die kerk in orde behoort te wees.
Amen.
Now to you people that may be here from out, heard me speak it, that's the way it should be. See, the message goes forth. See, the results, it happens right then. Something takes place, just exactly like discernment or any other spirit. Isn't he wonderful?
Nou aan julle mense wat hier mag wees van buiten, wat my dit oor sê het, dis hoe dit behoort te wees, sien die boodskap gaan uitsien die resultate, dit gebeur net dan. Iets gebeur net precies, soos onderscheiding of enige ander gees, is hy nie wonderlik nie.
Oh, I'm so glad to know that that same thing that was ordained by St. Paul right here, hasn't died down to right here. Still the same thing. Oh, I'm so glad I can say I'm one of them, aren't you? All right.
Ek so bly om te weet dat daar dieselfde ding wat ingestel is deur Paulus net hier, het nie weggesterf tot net hier nie. Steeds dieselfde ding. O, ek so bly dat ek kan sê ek's een van hulle. Is julle nie? Goed.
Now, tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, we're taking the age of Laodicea. And that's the marriage age. I want you to come if you possibly can. Now, it's just a little late tonight because maybe the Holy Spirit's speaking and so forth. But it's early. It's only about 20 minutes after 9. And usually I'm here at 10 or 11 o'clock. So that's really early down here.
Môre aand om 7 uur neem ons die tydperk van Laodicea. En dis die huwelikstydperk. Ek wil hê julle moet kom as julle enig iets kan. Ek was net 'n bietjie laat vanaand, miskien omdat die Heilige Gees gespreek het en so voort. Maar dis nog vroeg. Dis net omtrent 20 minute oor 9. En gewoonlik is ek hier 10 of 11 uur. So dis baie vroeg hieronder.
So, do you enjoy the messages of the Lord? You really feed your soul? God bless you, my children. You know, I love you with all my heart. And sometimes when the Spirit gets a hold of me, it cuts both. That's the way the word is. It's sharp like a two-edged sword. It cuts coming, going, in or outward, every way. But that's what circumcises us. Circumcision is cuts off the surplus flesh, the things that we ought to have.
So geniet julle die boodskappe van die Here. Geniet julle dit regtig. Dit voed julle siel. God seën julle my kinders. Julle weet, ek het julle lief met my hele hart en partykeer as die Gees my beet kry, sny dit na beide. Dis hoe die woord is. Dis skerp soos 'n tweesnydende swaard. Dit sny met die kom gaan binne buite op elke manier. Maar dis wat ons besny. Besnydende sny net oor tollige vlees af die dinge wat ons nie behoort te hê nie.
Now I want you to notice, did you hear the Spirit on the interpretation tonight? Stop that foolishness. That circumcises. Be sincere. We all get off the line, but God knows how to shave the bumps off of us. He certainly does. I'm thankful for it, aren't you?
Nou ek wil hier julle moet oplet. Het julle die Gees met die uitleg gehoor vanavond? Staak daar die dwaasheid. Dit besny, wees opreg. Ons raak allemaal die pad bijster, maar God weet hoe om die knoppen van ons af te skeer. Doen hy dit nie? Hy doen beslis. Ek's dankbaar daarvoor. Is jylle nie?
Are you the little pianist here? I don't see. Is Teddy? I don't see him here. All right, sister, if you will. Is that your daughter, Brother Dalton?
Daughter-in-law.
Mighty fine little lady. So glad that you're a Christian.
Is jy die klein pianiste hier? Ek sien nie, is Teddy, ek sien hom nergens hier nie, is hierdie goed sister, as jy sal, is dit jou dochter, broer Dalton, skoondochter, goed, baie gawe dame, ek is so bly dat jy 'n Christen is.
All right, what's our good old dismissing song? Let's try one just before we do now, just a minute sister, before we sing, take the name of Jesus with you. How many knows, don't forget the family prayer? How many prays in your family prays? Oh, that's good. Let's try it once, just like old times now.
Goed, wat is ons goeie ou verdag geslied? Laat ons een probeer net voor ons dit doen nou. Net 'n oomblik, sister. Voor ons neem die naam van Jesus met jou sing. Hoeveel ken vergeet tog nooit die gesinsgebed? Hoeveel bid in julle familie? Julle familie bid. O, dis goed. Kom ons probeer dit een keer net soos ou tye nou.
Don't
vergeet
tog
nooit die gesinsgebed.
Jesus, won't you meet you there? He will take your heart and sword heaven.
Oh, don't forget the
innocent bread.
You like that? Let's try it again.
Hou jullie daarvan? Kom eens, probeer dit weer.
Don't vergeet toch nooit die gezinsbeheer. Jesus won you daar ook there.
You got a date now.
Je hebt een afspraak nou.
He neem al je zorgen weg.
Oh, vergeet toch nooit die gezinsbeheer. Sure can, sister. Sister Nash, that's very fine. Oh, if you just...
Kan beslis, sister. Sister Nash, dis baie goed. O, as jy net sal.
If as we ons net op hom vertrou, sal hy jou voorbaar behou.
Just neem jou laste na die jorde van die dag. Laat u dag, laat u dag. Neem jou laste na die jorde van die dag. As ons net op hom vertrouw, sal hy jou voorwaar behoud. Neem jou laste na die jord en laat al daar.
Don't you like them old hymns? Oh, I believe that man picked up the pen and was inspired by the Holy Ghost to read that.
Hou julle nie van daar die ou lieder nie? O, ek net. Ek glo daar die manne het die pen opgetel, is geïnspireerd deur die Heilige Gees om dit te lees.
Amen.
Like Bland Finney Crosby, when them worldly people of that day tried to make a right worldly song, said, well, you'll be a rich woman. She said, I have dedicated my life to Christ. And all my talents, she blind, you know, said, I owe my life and all to Christ.
So this Bland Finney Crosby, to die wereldse mense van daardie dag haar wereldse liedjes wou laat skryf, gesê, wel, jy sal 'n ryk vrou wees, sê, het gesê, ek het my lewe aan Christus gewy, en my hele talent, sy was blind, jylle weet, gesê, ek skuld my lewe en alles aan Christus.
She said, and then they kind of got peeved at her because she turned down such an opportunity. She didn't sell her birthrights like Mr. Presley and them did, but she maintained her integrity. So they left her, said, and when you get to heaven, if there is such a place, said, if you're like you are here, you'll be blind. Said, what if you are blind? Said, how would you know him? She said, I'll know him. I'll know him.
Sy het gesê, en toe het hulle soort van kwaad geraak vir haar, omdat sy so geleentheid geweier het. Sy het nie haar geboorterecht verkoop soos meneer Presley en hulle het nie, maar sy het haar integriteit behou, soos sy sê, hulle het haar gelos gesê. Dan wanneer hy in die hemel kom, is daar so 'n plek, is gesê, as jy is soos wat jy hier is, sal jy blind wees, gesê. Wat as jy blind is, gesê, hoe sou jy hom ken? Sy het gesê, ek sal hom ken. Ek sal hom ken.
Said, what if you're blind? What if you are blind? She said, I'll feel for the prints of the nails. Then she turned around. She started walking back, she said,
gesê, wat as jy blind is? Wat as jy blind is? Sy het gesê, ek sal voel vir die merke van die spykers. Toe het sy omgedraai, sy het agter toe begin loop, en sy het gesê, ek sal hom ken, ek sal hom ken, en verloos aan sy sê, sal ek staan. Ek sal hom ken, ek sal hom ken, aan die merke van die spekers in sy hand.
Jesus, with those 5 precious wounds bleeding for me under, how could I ever deny that precious one? Let me die, let me go the way of anything, but never let me deny that precious bleeding one under that died for me. Yes.
O my Jesus, met daar die 5 kostbare wonde, wat vir my gebloei het daar oorkant, hoe kan ek ooit daar die kostbare een verloon? Laat my sterf, laat ek gaan, laat my die weg van enig iets volg, maar laat my nooit daar die kostbare bloeiende een oorkant verloon, wat vir my gesterf het nie. Ja.
And as you leave tonight, you want to take the name of Jesus with you. All right, sister, shall we stand now? All
right. En soos jylle vanavond vertrek, wil jylle die naam van Jesus met jylle neem. Goed, sister, sal ons nou staan allemaal saam.
Die naam van Jesus met jou, ten van proefbed en van woon. Het sal jou vreugde en interest geen, neem het wel met jou naam. Dierbare naam. Dierbare naam, oorsoek, hartse hoop en hemel vreugd. Dierbare naam, oorsoek, hartse hoop en hemel vreugd.
As we bow our heads and softly sing,
nou soos ons hoofde buig en sag sing, oor die naam van Jesus nabij, voor sy voete nou meer val. Koning van konings in die hemel, bekroon ons om, as ons reis voltooi is. Dierbare naam, oor sy, hartse hoop en